Last year, we never got to see Bo Levi Mitchell take his new team into Calgary. This year, we'll get that out of the way fast. Overall, 2023 was not a season Bo will remember fondly, but he gets a chance to make it all right now. And no better place to get that started than the place he called home for 10 seasons. It's the Ticats and Stampeders coming up on Friday Night Football.
It's Friday from coast to coast. The CFL is Canada's game. Well, we're all pumped up to party, and we're ready for a fight. Come on, kick back, relax, watching Friday Night Football. Boys are too bad, playing CFL football. Game is up for grabs, it's Friday.
And here he is, the man himself, coming back to the home he built, Bo Levi Mitchell. He is about to put on a show, guys.
Well, the man who's now occupying that house, Jake Mayer, he's lost a few pounds. He's feeling pretty good this offseason. Similar to CFL on TSN, star producer Jamie Rydell, thin in the waist and cute in the face.
Tell him, baby. Timothy White led the CFL last year with 1,269 yards on just 75 receptions. But that was with three different quarterbacks. If he can have Bo all year long, I think it's safe to say he'll surpass that number.
Reggie Bagleton had to do it all last year as injuries decimated the Stamps receiving corps. Even Reggie himself missed three games, but he still managed 1,100 yards and is hoping the guys around him can stay upright this season. And welcome Canada inside our CFL on TSN Studios for the first Friday Night Football game of the season, along with the panel of Milt Stegall, Davis Sanchez, and Enoch Mwamba. We've also got Paul Lapolice, Dave Naylor. It'll be a cast of thousands. But before we get to them, let's get to McMahon and bring in Britt Dort, who is right there in the eye of the hurricane. We know that Bo Levi Mitchell didn't want to leave Calgary. It wasn't his decision, but ultimately he took the departure gracefully. What's the vibe right now as Bo comes home, a game that's 2 years in the making?
A lot of buzz around McMahon Stadium, and I feel like there's probably a lot of emotions. However, we both chatted with him yesterday when he first got back to Calgary, and we asked him about those emotions, and he said, honestly, I don't know how I'm going to feel until I run out of the tunnel and I'm on the other side of the stadium wearing a different jersey. You guys just talked about it. The last game when he was here, he actually told me that's his favorite memory in McMahon Stadium, and he said it came with a lot of emotion. He also joked, you know, it wasn't the best time. I was getting replaced. However, the crowd erupted for me on my last snap as a Calgary Stampeder, and that's something that I hold really close in my heart. It's been a long time coming. We've been waiting for the return of Bo Levi Mitchell. I asked him about that, and you know, if it changes anything, the fact that it didn't happen last season and now we're two seasons out of it, he said, actually, I think it builds the anticipation a bit, and I'm happy it wasn't last year because chances are I would have been hurt for that game and I would have had to miss it, so I'm happy to have it. He also talked about the fact I love playing on the road. He said, I love playing in front of an away crowd. I don't know if this away crowd's going to be a little different here tonight, but he did say week one, game one, what more could I ask for on the schedule to come back here and have an away game in this house?
Thank you very much, Britt. Let's take a look at Bo's record in Calgary. Won almost 75% of his games, actually more than 75%. Completions high in terms of passing yards. He's the Stamps leader in all-time passing yards. 188 touchdown passes, 89 interceptions. And guys, when we look at Bo Levi Mitchell, we'll start with you. This is a guy that's had a lot of injuries the last few years. We know what peak Bo looks like. We just haven't seen it in a while. So what can we see this time?
Well, you know this game. He wants to tear the Calgary Stampeders up. But you talk about peak Bo. But last 3 years, we haven't seen the best of Bo. I think it's, 25 touchdowns, the 29 interceptions. But this is his last opportunity to get it back. Let's be honest. If it doesn't work out for him this year, Bo will maybe be on this panel because that'll be it for him. So he understands what's at stake. He understands that this is his last opportunity, but it's a great opportunity. It's a great opportunity for him to finally go out and do what he's been trying to do since he left the Calgary Stampeders, and that's lead these Hamilton Tiger Cats to a championship.
Yeah, I wonder what it is that we know how much Bo wants this, right? We know just because of how things played out, how much Bo wants, how much it means to him, and how much, you know, the city of Calgary means to Bo. But what could he do that's different? Like you said it, Farhan. What have we seen in the last few years to make us believe? And you think he's going to be successful tonight? I said I think he has a big game. I think you feel the same way, Knock. But why? You can't just flick a switch. Yeah. This is an important game. I used to play here. Now I'm going to be great. Like, he has not been great for the last 3 years, maybe not even good. I don't know what's gonna change here, but I'll tell you this, it's must see TV because I want to see it. This is, Bo is a big game player. Let's see what happens.
Well, you know what? The one thing that did change is Coach Milanovic's, his arrival to Hamilton, and yeah. I think that that's gonna help him tremendously. And you know, he's quite, you know, he's been known to be a quarterback whisperer, so to say, but I really think that that combination right there is going to bode well for Bo Levi Mitchell, and it's going to allow him to do, Milt, like you talked about, exactly that. Have success this season starting in Calgary.
So hold on. So you think a coach can have that much impact on, especially Bo, who 10 years before that, he was killing it, and, you know, he started struggling, and a coach can come in and have that much of an impact?
I really think he's at a really good place in his career. And the issues that he's had the last couple of years, yes, he changed teams, and he came into a new one. But one of the main issues has been his health, right? Being healthy and injuries and whatnot. And I truly believe, again, the combination of working together with a quarterback coach that understands the position and the stage that he's at in his career is going
to
help.
So from a strictly executional standpoint, I know this about Scott. He's a lot of three-step drop, a lot of quick game.
Right.
And Bo, they have said that he has worked on his mechanics, and in particular his three-step. So let's look at that as actual from an execution standpoint. Is he tighter in his three-step drop? Is there something mechanically that he's done there? Maybe that's it, but it's not a magic potion, guys.
No,
it's not just he's home and he got a Spalumbo sandwich, whatever it is, and he's going to be good.
Well, hey, look, you look good in the preseason. The quarter and a half that he did play, we'll see if he can carry that over. As for the folks in Calgary, they loved Bo because he was winning. And you know he just wants to add to that legacy on this field, but with different colors. It's Bo against his own team. Coming up, it's the CFL on TSN.
It's been a few years since this team has had a feature back.
Inside run, the Butler did it. Touchdown, Hamilton.
Look at him go. Butler putting on a clinic. Touchdown, Butler. What an effort, and the Ticats are on the board.
James Butler cuts back to the five, dives to the end zone. Touchdown, Tiger Cats.
We said the Hamilton Tiger Cats need a superhero. James Butler has been.
In just three seasons, James Butler has made himself one of the most complete running backs in the CFL. Elusive and violent, he's stout in pass protection and can also create out of the backfield. But as he goes one-on-one with our Matthew Schenetti, Butler also believes that he can create in a number of other areas.
Back at it again, another day, vlogging, content creating.
It's a little interesting for me to be in front of the camera when a player is holding it.
Yeah.
Content has become a passion of yours.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about your vlog.
I've always liked vlogs. I've always liked the gym vlogs that people do. I like to travel with me vlogs, I like to get ready with me vlogs. I've always wanted to do something that I can be creative. I'm sorry for anybody who watched my first vlog. It's so bad.
Why am I so dark? Bro, it is so bright in here.
I didn't know camera settings, and I didn't really understand that, oh, you can make your camera like,
you just fix the iris?
I didn't know how to do that. I still have some videos that I haven't posted that, like, the camera was unfocused, so it's all blurry. I remember my last vlog, I said, sorry for the blurriness. Every time I'm going back, I'm just like, oh, I wish I had a camera. I wish I knew what I was doing.
Well, today is your lucky day.
Yeah.
As our DOP, Nigel here, can answer all of your troubleshooting questions.
Mm-hmm.
Nigel, would you like the chair?
Sure. Okay.
Okay. Hit me up.
So, my first question is, when I'm training, sometimes when I'm far away, it gets a little blurry.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering, do I keep it on autofocus or should I manual focus?
I would definitely keep it on autofocus. All these cameras now today are so good with autofocusing.
Mm-hmm.
When I touch the screen here,
right, on your face, it'll autofocus on your face. So once it recognizes your face, it will track you. And one of the hardest things to do is actually manually focus following someone coming towards you.
For sure.
And then, sorry, one sec. James is now out of focus on your camera, Nigel.
Oh.
So.
Wow, see, that's why I need a cameraman.
this is exactly why you need a camera.
It should have stayed on you, so there you go. We're back in focus now.
And then also, when it comes to brightness, it's always a little off, and sometimes it's on. That was, like, the coolest thing I've ever, like, learned in my life. It's like, wow, I just fixed the brightness. I thought, like, I cracked DaVinci's code.
See, now I'm not dark.
There's something in here that I'm seeing right now where it's saying plus one.
Yeah, like 1.3 or
so
something like that.
So that's an exposure index where it's adjusting it a little bit brighter.
I've just been on Google how to fix brightness on camera. Thank you.
Perfect. You're welcome.
You want to grill me now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There you go.
All right. Thank you, Nigel.
You're welcome. What do you want to know?
How did you get to where you are game day here, like when it comes to interviewing and all that?
So has it been patience for you with the coaching staff, or you've been trying to petition them to get more involved?
You know, my thing, I'm never going to lobby for more touches.
What you're doing is very much what I had to do, is you take a risk. Right? And the risk that you take is, I was a writer, I was a newspaper reporter, and the opportunity came up because they thought, hey, you have tried some creative storytelling in newspaper reporting, would you like to try in front of camera? And the one thing that I realized is it's a lot of patience, right? The process of understanding preparation, the process of kind of understanding what you have to do to be ready to find not only your voice in front of camera, but your presence in front of camera, and what you really realize is, relax. You'll find that over time, won't happen right away, but you'll be who you want to be in front of camera.
Stuff like that, it's great, great content. That's great content.
My favorite quote, you'll probably hear me say this 1,000 times, if you can't stay motivated, stay consistent. So, love. Hope y'all enjoy.
Now, how did Shinetti become the center of that feature? We'll have to figure that content, out. But content. Joined now by the coach, Paul Lapolis. And Lapo, probably 7 of the 9 teams in the CFL like to use the Milanovic offense, named after Scott Milanovic. Well, he goes to the NFL. He comes back, and he comes back with some tweaks. So tell me how, because it seems like most of those tweaks are in the run game, how he plans to use James Butler. Yeah, I saw them in training camp, and they run something farhand called the gap scheme. There's two types in the Canadian Football League. They run either zone schemes or gap schemes. You and I, we're going to be linemen. Ellen is our middle linebacker. The camera's our middle linebacker. This is what zone blocking looks like. We walk together. We don't move too far. The middle linebacker can stay with us, and the back tries to find a spot. As we come back, this is what happens in a gap scheme. Ready? Go set hut. Bang. He steps down. I move out of the way. Now Ellen's trying to find me. She's the linebacker trying to find where the ball is going to go. Ellen was really hard at that, or she just doesn't want me on camera tonight. That might be it. Let's watch Hamilton, a couple of their plays that they like to run. Can't wait to see James Butler this season in this scheme. All right, this is a kicker and a wrapper. You have two people pulling to the point of attack. So the point of attack is going to move where those two players go. The hard part for the defense is now the two linebackers have to move over to now fit their area of the field, their gaps. And it's very difficult to run across the field and go find them. Once again, James Butler gets a really good run. These are runs from when Scott took over last year, the first 2 games after Scott took over. Here are your gaps. At the line of scrimmage, the linemen and linebackers have to be there to stop the linemen, the back from running. Here's a kicker and a double team. At the point of attack, great job execution on the double team, and then Revenberg gets off on the linebacker. You are trying to create seams and move the defense. Once again, another opportunity to show his ability to put his foot in the ground and get north-south. This time, down block, there is a kickout player, but BC has an unblocked player at the point of attack. But the problem is he's lined up outside, the ball hits inside. The beauty of separating the defense with all these pull schemes, it makes it difficult. I saw this on film. I love this. It's a wide receiver screen and a lineman pulling. And what are they going to do? They're going to add a fullback into the line of scrimmage. This is a conflict of assignment. The end widens, you hand it off.
So there's a lot of different things you can do with James Butler, and I was really looking forward to seeing what he does tonight, because I think Scott's going to have a really good play. You know, I know Bo's going to be important, yep, but I think James Butler is crucial to the success of this team this season.
Well, and he was dealing with a foot injury coming into training camp or early in camp, didn't take part in either preseason game. He was a game-time decision heading in tonight, but he is going to play. And, you know, the fans in Calgary aren't going to want to see this guy. He could be the secret weapon. We're looking at the quarterbacks. It could be the running backs. They're tailgating. They're getting ready for a big one in Cowtown. Joined now by our insider, Dave Naylor. And Dave, in last night's season opener between Winnipeg and Montreal, we saw four missed kicks, including a pair of PATs that were missed. Following the game, we saw a number of kickers on social media come out in support of Sergio Castillo, who was upset by his performance and the potential impact of these footballs that had microchips placed in those balls. The kickers aren't comfortable with it. The league reacted today. They made a change. They said that kickers no longer have to use those balls. They have the option. How did we get to this point?
Well, it began after the game last night in Winnipeg, where Sergio Castillo, as you mentioned, missed two field goals and an extra point. He was open with his comments that he was not comfortable kicking the footballs with the microchips on them. And I think he'd made some comments, or his feelings at least, known before the game. There were a number of kickers who were using those balls through training camp in the preseason, expressed some hesitation. He was one of them. He goes out, has a bad night on night number one, and he made those comments public. Hence, you see the support that he got from other kickers, Brett Lowther, Lewis Ward, and others on social media. Now, the CFL, in terms of microchipping footballs, this actually began last season, but not for the kicking game. So quarterbacks were using them. They didn't have any issue. They brought in testing this offseason, primarily with robotic kickers. And in their evidence, they said there was no proven evidence that there was an effect on performance of having a microchip in there that weighed less than half an ounce. They're working with a company called Sportable to develop this technology. But out of respect for the kickers, and obviously there's a mental aspect of this as well, they made a proposal to the CFL Players Association, who wanted this addressed, and said, hey, we will give teams the choice. And by getting the choice, it means you've got to decide before the game for all kicking plays, kickoff, punts, field goals, all of it. You're either using the microchip balls or you're not. And the league will continue, of course, to try to go forward and refine this technology, try to satisfy the kickers so that in 2025 this can be mandated. This is all about getting data for broadcast augmentation. The CFLPA was on board with this, but they obviously want to stand up for their kickers, who are not completely on board with it at this time.
And certainly in the case of Castillo, he's a 90% kicker. We were surprised, guys, to see him miss those kicks, but I'm also surprised that they made this decision this quickly after the regular season has started. Is there any kind of advantage for any of the kickers who now don't have to kick with these footballs?
It's not fair. It's not fair. Every team in their first game, including Ottawa, who has a bye this week, who plays next week, should have to kick with this chip in their balls. It's not fair to Winnipeg and Montreal. And the other question I have, 13 grams less than a half, does that really make a difference? Does that really make a difference? Or are these guys just using it as an excuse? Now, I've never been a kicker, so I don't want to put that on it, but we're talking about 13 grams. Please. I don't know if that makes a difference.
From the fact that a lot of guys have been complaining, the biggest thing that I take away from this, and I think we can all agree, is that if the league is choosing to do the right thing at this very moment, it is a good thing. Now, look, the question is, like you mentioned, Milt, why and how come everybody else or every other kicker doesn't get to do the same thing that Sergio Castillo also went through last night?
Yeah, I agree with both of you guys on that point. I'm going to add this is, how many quarterbacks, how many offensive coordinators want live mics? Like, there's certain things that I'm sure players that we might not want, but you have to balance, you know, things you implement to help grow the game and into those things that also might impact the product on the field. So if it's something that the league thinks can benefit, now you got to weigh how much does that affect the actual kicking. And so far it's looked like it's impacted it, but I'd like to hear from some other guys as well. But there's that fine balance between, you know, improving the game for fan experience, whatever else it may be, and impacting the product on the field.
And Chez, some people have asked, why do we need, or why does the league need to put chips in balls that are being kicked? Is there that much interest in kicking data? Well, there's also the return game. When there's a missed field goal and you have a player take that ball out of the end zone and go up the field, that chip is registering the data with him, and that's the other part of it. Since the return game is such a big part, and that may be where the league is more interested in getting data than the actual kicks. Yeah.
Just quickly, I just want to make a point that Dave Naylor made. I'm just stealing his point where he said, well, now what if a quarterback comes off the field and say, hey, I threw those five interceptions because the chip was in the ball. What do you do then? Because the chips are in the ball when they're a live play for offense and defense. What do you do then if a quarterback comes?
I thought these were just kicking balls. These are balls that are used for
the chips are in the ball. But the regular balls, they have chips in them also.
Okay, got it. Ultimately, as far as tonight's game is concerned, we do know that Calgary's going to go back to using the old balls as far as Rene Paradis' kicks are concerned. Haven't heard back yet from Hamilton, but it does seem like this change is going to take hold this weekend, and we won't see many of the chip balls used by kickers going forward. The Stampeders are 4-0 all-time in season openers against Hamilton, with all of the contests having been played at McMahon. Let's see if they can keep that trend going. Milt, now let's head back to the field.
It's not fair, Milt.
Where Britt Dorn's standing by with Bo.
Well, Bo, you said you didn't know how you were going to feel until you ran out of the other tunnel at McMahon Stadium. So how are you feeling in this moment?
I'm excited. I'm ready to get the season going. Got really excited watching the game last night. Jealous of the boys already playing. So excited to get out there, excited to play in front of the fans.
When you think back to young Bo back in 2012 coming out to the stadium and the roller coaster you had last season, did you ever think you'd finally get to this moment and be here in your career?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. You know, I think for a long time I probably thought I'd be here my whole career. And I always wanted to play in one place, and then when it didn't happen, my thought process was like, all right, commit to that next team and stay there for the rest of your career.
Well, I know your ears have been ringing because everybody's been talking about you this week, including the panel. Any words for them ahead of game one?
Hey, Milt, you lied to me. You lied to me on who you were picking. All right, I won't forget that.
Have a good game, Bob.
Well,
I picked Hamilton to be in the Grey Cup.
You did, but did you pick him to win tonight?
We didn't pick anybody to win tonight. We haven't picked. I don't know what Bo was talking about.
Athletes manufacturing motivation, right?
I think that's what it is. Yeah, manufacturing motivation. Bo,
you're just finding
Bo.
A reason.
I picked Bo. I'm still drinking the Bo Kool-Aid. It's not as sweet as it used to be, and I'm still trying to get some.
There's a lot of talk about the Bo thing. There's also a matchup here. Jake versus Bo. Not just Bo versus Calgary, but also Jake versus Bo. This is, I think, Jake Mayer has some thoughts on wanting to prove that they made the right move with him, too.
Yeah. Jake definitely has a lot to prove, but that whole defense is going to have to face the wrath of Bo Levi Mitchell coming back.
Wow. Well, what we can say is that Bo and Milt aren't going to be hugging it out anytime soon, but all is love between Bo and his former coaches in Calgary. He and Dave Dickinson earlier tonight had a chance to get reacquainted a little bit. They shared plenty of good times, and I'm sure they will again after the game. We'll see who winds up winning this one. He had a pair of Grey Cups and a pair of MOPs in Calgary, a gunslinger in every sense of the word.
We don't have to be like everyone, stuck inside this broken
over the top. Tim White over the shoulder. Touchdown, Tiger Cats.
Towards the end zone. Reggie Bagleton lays out. Touchdown, Calgary.
It's Friday. From coast to coast. The CFL is Canada's game.
It has been almost two seasons since this man took to the field in Calgary as a starting quarterback. Bo Levi Mitchell returns to McMahon. He is the franchise's all-time leader in passing yards. He was replaced by this man, Jake Mayer. Everybody has been talking about Bo, but Jake also has something to prove. Last season, he was the only starting quarterback in the CFL to stay healthy, but His performance at times was something he definitely wanted to improve on. It is Bo, it is Jake, it is Friday Night Football, and it is the panel, Milt Stegall, Davis Sanchez, Enoch Mwamba, guys. And, you know, we spent a lot of time in the pregame show talking about Bo, but let's talk a bit about Jake. And if you are him and you are hearing all of this talk about the other guy, how important is tonight to you?
Well, he's just trying to get back on track. Yes, tonight is important, but he understands that, you know, they gave him the keys to the franchise, and last year he didn't uphold his part of the deal. We talk about, you know, when he first stepped on the field, how well he was playing so well that they felt they can get rid of Bo Levi Mitchell. But last year there were some people whispering, like, maybe we shouldn't have gotten rid of Bo Levi. So this is his first opportunity for the year to prove everyone wrong and say last year was just a fluke.
Yeah, and the jury's still out with Jake. He's young, but also third most pressure faced last year. We look at percentage of pressure faced. So he didn't have great protection, so let's add that. Lost his number one receiver, add that. There's a lot going on, but I want to see Bo.
Yep.
If they go off, Bo has a big game, I want to see how he reacts. That will really tell us how important this was to him, because the true emotions come out in the game.
You talk about Jake Mayer underperforming after Bo's departure. The one person to me that he needs to rely on is Reggie Begelton. He is going to have to rely on him if he wants to have the success that he needs to have to prove everybody wrong, because right now it hasn't been looking so good so far since Bo's departure.
And as we know, Bo is not facing Jake. Bo is facing the Calgary defense. It is their home opener. They are also going to want to put on a show against their former leader. It is Calgary. It is Hamilton. Friday Night Football coming up on TSN.
Bo Levi Mitchell, all this guy knows is winning. The Calgary Stampeders are the Grey Cup champions. Bo Levi Mitchell, he has now a Grey Cup champion. Is there anything Bo Levi Mitchell can't do?
Mitchell, touchdown, easily done.
Mitchell's got to take off, looking for Grey. Got it. Touchdown. The Stampeders are over the hump.
The MVP of the 2018 Grey Cup, Bo Levi Mitchell.
Crystal Adamo of Airdrie, Alberta. This is your chance to win big thanks to Save On Foods' $1 million touchdown to win. If a kickoff is returned for a touchdown, you could win groceries for a year. If two kickoffs are returned for touchdowns in this game, you could also win $1 million. Good luck, Crystal. Now let's send it to McMahon.
It's a beautiful but breezy evening in Calgary as we kick off another season of Friday Night Football with the Stampeders set to host the Ticats at McMahon Stadium. And the Stampeders last year, they were a playoff team, but they only won 6 games, certainly a number they want to improve on. Tonight, it's a familiar face on the other side as one of the best in franchise history. Bo Levi Mitchell returns to McMahon for the first time.
Yeah, we won't bury the headline. Let's start with Hamilton's Bo Levi Mitchell, who played 62 games as a Stamp starting quarterback here at McMahon Stadium, won 47 of them. On that journey, he won 2 MOPs, 2 Grey Cup MVPs. He returns to his own stomping grounds for the first time. The man that replaced Bo is Jake Mayer on the other sideline. Mayer was the only quarterback last year to start all 18 games, threw for over 4,000 yards and led the Stamps to a playoff spot. He's looking to take the next step this year.
Just 3 home wins last season for Dave Dickinson, a number that they will certainly like to improve after the years of success that they had here. And there's Scott Milanovich getting set to begin his head coaching career with the Ticats. From 2012 to 2016, he was with the Argos, got the job in Edmonton, never actually had a chance to do it. And now here he is with the Hamilton Tiger Cats, and we are set and ready to get rolling. Calgary won the toss. They deferred. Hamilton said, give us the ball, and they will get it as this is kicked away. Friday Night Football underway as it is taken just inside the 10 and returned back out just shy of the 30 in the hands of Lawrence Woods. And there is Bo Levi Mitchell in the house of McMahon.
I mentioned his record here at McMahon Stadium as a member of the Calgary Stampeders, their all-time leading passer. He's 47-13-2. This will be game 63 for him in this stadium. A lot of good memories, some downs as well, but he knows the fans will give him a warm welcome, and it sounds like they are.
Since 2021, the Ticats are combined 8-16 in June, July, and August, which means they need to find a way to
too
get
many
off
players
to a better
Hamilton
start.
It's a 5-yard penalty.
Well, that's not going to be
first down.
That's not it. Still, though, you have to start better than the Ticats have started.
Yeah, no question. Right? Yeah, I mean, both these teams are sort of middle-of-the-pack teams, you know, kind of getting into the playoffs barely, and they want to take the next step, start to show some dominance in their divisions, maybe host a playoff game or better, host that final.
Hamilton last year ended up losing to Montreal 27-12 in the East semifinal. They start here after the penalty, first and 15 on their own 27, and they will hand it off to Butler. Short pickup. Let's take a look at this Hamilton starting offense this evening.
Two rookie tackles, Quentin Barrow on one side, Brendan Bordner on the other. We'll see how they hold up in their first game in the Canadian Football League. And there's the leading receiver in the CFL last year in Tim White. He is back. James Butler was a game day decision. The decision, he's playing.
He's good to go. Back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons for James Butler. Back-to-back 1,200-yard campaigns for Tim White. Mitchell with time. He's going to heave one down the far sideline, and that one falls incomplete. He was looking for Shamar Bridges, one of the newcomers in this Ticats offense.
Yeah, taking a shot early, nothing wrong with that. Even if you don't hit this throw, this sends a little bit of a message. Two real veteran, we'll get to them in a second, but veteran corners in Calgary secondary this year.
Nick Constantinou, the Australian punter from Texas A&M, will kick this away. Lets it fly from just outside his own 15. An 11-kilometer-per-hour wind here. 44-yard kick will be returned to the 45, and there is Jake Mayer, another year as the starting quarterback of the Calgary Stampeders.
Yeah, when Jake Mayer, you know, started a couple of years back, Bo Levi Mitchell was the starter. He started to play very well. Bo got into some injury issues, and they felt like at this organization that they could take that next step, move on to a younger quarterback. And then last year, sort of middle of the road, there were flashes from Jake Mayer that he really looked good, like he was ready to take that next step. Didn't quite fulfill it, but he did make the playoffs.
Empty backfield here. Mayer throwing down the field a little too high, and that one falls incomplete as he was looking for Cam Eccles.
John McEwen was the nominee for outstanding lineman for the Calgary Stampeders. He's back in the middle trying to keep those guys together. Good veteran group, though, up front. And they got Bagleton back. Reggie Bagleton, 30 years old, outstanding player nominee for the Stamps a year ago. A couple newcomers we'll get to in that receiving core. But there is one that you know Jake Mayer will lean on.
Second and 10 from the Calgary 46. Mayer looks to his left, flushed out of the pocket, takes off to the right, looking down the field. He'll throw, and he's got a completion down to the 40 as Jake Mayer uses his feet to escape trouble and sends it down the field. And he's got Cam Eccles, who had a great preseason for his first CFL catch. It goes for 26 yards.
Yeah, we talked to Jake this week, coming back, and asked him about his offseason training. He said, I want to become more athletic. I know that at times, quite often, plays will break down. It's not exactly how you write them up. I want to be more athletic with the ability to escape, get outside, maybe throw on the run more. And he shows that early in this one.
Not an easy throw to make.
Nope.
Comes crossbody. Eccles, the rookie, 29 years old, comes back to the ball and makes the catch. Now they'll hand it off to Mills, right up the middle. Short pickup down to the 35. Here's Hamilton's defense.
Nice offseason acquisition up front in Brandon Barlow from the Toronto Argonauts, coming in after a nice campaign with 9 quarterback sacks. There's Kyle Wilson is the veteran in the middle of the linebacking core. 2 rookies on either side of him and 2 rookie corners for the Hamilton Tiger Cats. So Katsutanas, who played a very good second half of the season last year, is going to have to keep those guys lined upright.
5 interceptions last year for the former UBC Thunderbird at safety for the Tigers. 2nd and 7. Mayer pressure right in his face, and that is batted away. In complete right up the middle. That's who we were just talking about. The safety, Katsitonis, wasted no time. Timed that one perfectly.
Yeah, he did. And this is, you know, he had a few interceptions late in the season. He's coming from off the line of scrimmage and times it up real nice. Straight through the middle. Jake Mayer had to try and throw it around him. Couldn't get it done. And a knockdown for Katsitonis right out of the gate.
Within the field goal range of the 39-year-old six-time All-Star Paredes.
Chip or no chip? We'll get to that later.
My answer is always chips. Give me chips.
Timeout. Hamilton.
Well, that was.
Might have had a personnel issue there. Didn't want to get a penalty, give Calgary a first down with too many men on the field, so they had to burn a timeout.
For those of you not aware of the chip conversation that we were having, chips in the ball this year causing some issues with kickers around the league. The league announcing today that the teams will have the option to kick with the chipped ball or the unchipped ball.
Yeah,
so seems like an issue that's been taken care of rather quickly.
Yeah, it was. And, the you know, just in case the kickers are concerned with it, and some of them were, so that's okay. I think it was a great decision by the league. And I would like to try an experiment. 20 balls. Paredes doesn't know which one has the chip. You kick him and you tell us how it goes.
If they can go perfect, then you're like, okay, you know what, you have a case.
Am I saying it might be in their heads? Yeah, kind of.
No problem for Paredes as he hammers that one right down the middle, and the Calgary Stampeders on the board, 3-0 the lead. Who's this? That's a baby face. Bo Levi Mitchell back in 2013. There he is today with the Hamilton Tiger Cats. More on him when we return. Calgary, the home of Bo Levi Mitchell for a decade, and what can you say? Two Grey Cups, two Grey Cup MOPs, two-time All-Star, two 5,000-yard seasons, and being honored here tonight at McMahon.
Back to McMahon, and thank him for the countless memories he provided the Stampeders faithful while wearing the red and white.
Very nice.
Fans, standing on your feet and welcome back to McMahon Stadium.
Emotional evening for Bo's family, no doubt.
And that's great for the classy for the Calgary fans to give him that welcome back. It feels weird that he is back and it's been this long. I mean, it's been a couple of years since the move and Jake Mayer taking over here in Calgary, but due to injuries and only one game last year between these two teams, that was late in the season in Hamilton. This is his first time back.
Starts this drive on his own 40. They'll get it to White, who turns, trying to find a little bit of space. Hesitation doesn't work. He gets taken down just shy of the 45. I mean, the resume that Bo Levi Mitchell put together here at the Stampeders, not much more you can accomplish.
No, absolutely not. And Hall of Fame numbers, over 32,000 yards passing. You mentioned the MOPs and the Grey Cup MVPs. And, yeah, I mean, just an outstanding win-loss record. Hall of Fame numbers.
Absolute. No doubt Hall of Famer. Now out to his right. He's got a little bit of space, and look at this. Mitchell over midfield with a slide. And he's got a first down for the Ticats.
Yeah, good conversations with Bo this week about this. You know, he's been talking about it all week in the return, and he's really looking forward to it. But he said, you know, what I really have to do is stay locked in. I mean, Scott Milenovich's system is new to the entire group, and we're working on it. And, you know, there is some familiarity. He's excited about being part of it. But he said, you got to be on top of your P's and Q's, cross every T and dot every I to make sure you're not making mistakes with this offense.
Mitchell goes to White, and a rare drop from Tim White. Back-to-back 8 touchdown seasons for number 12 in White there.
Yeah, I'm sure he has some mixed emotion. I remember talking to him a couple of years ago saying that he thought he'd be a Calgary Stampeder for his entire career. And of course, the one thing that is certain, about football and about pro sports is it's uncertain.
Very rare to go wire to wire, even with a career as good as the one that he put together here in Calgary. Mitchell in trouble again. This time they will take him down. Clarence Hicks with the first sack of his CFL career.
Yeah, that entire pocket just collapsed on him. It's a good group defensively when you think about the Calgary Stampeders. We'll get to that as this game goes on and just the sort of all-star caliber veterans that they have in that group. He's one of the newcomers coming off the edge in the rotation, and Hicks getting his first sack in the Canadian Football League.
Third and 19. Hammered away again. This will be taken at the 21. Nowhere to go on the return for Eric Brooks. Bo Levi. Hicks doesn't care that he played here. He gets home, takes him down for his first sack. Well, let's take you back to the game where the transition at quarterback began for the Calgary Stampeders. Bo Levi Mitchell back on August 20th. A couple of interceptions, August 20th, 2022. And Jake Mayer came into that game, and it's been Jake Mayer's job pretty much ever since. Let's send it down to Britt Dort for more on that.
Yeah, what I think most people don't realize, though, is that Jake and Bo, even though that might have been a tough moment for him, they're actually best friends on and off the field. They're also extremely competitive on and off the field. They told me when they both played for the Stamps, there was never a time there wasn't a wager on the line. Every single practice was who can hit more targets, who can have more accurate throws, and that continued off the field. They said we never played a game of cards or golfed without having some sort of wager, and got extremely competitive. Bo even said I would never let him play the ball anywhere else but where it lies, and they said tonight, we're going to come out on the field. We're going to give each other the nod because, yes, we are really good friends. But after that ball snapped, oh, it's go time. So I don't know what wager they have tonight, guys, but I'm sure it's a big one.
Yeah, and I asked Jake at the end of that conversation, okay, so who's the best golfer? He goes, oh, Bo's a really good golfer.
Apparently he's a great golfer. Second and five for Calgary. Backed up on a flag on the return. We're back on the ground again. Push it out towards the 20. Kadeem Carey, of course, no longer with the Calgary Stampeders. More of a workload for Dedrick Mills, who carried the ball at a 1,000-yard pace last season.
Yeah, interesting to see him as the feature guy. Top to bottom, they still have Peyton Logan on the roster, and we will see a little bit of him in the offense as well, like we did last year. But it is Dedrick Mills' job to tailback this season.
BJ Emmons on the sideline as well for them at running back.
Might be trying to draw him offside, but Tommy Stevens, I know Coach Dickinson has confidence in him. That's a big one, that deep in your own end.
He's a big man, but he managed to move enough to his right to pick up the first down early in a season. That's a big play call. Well, it's the first quarter of game one, but still.
I'm just saying, that'll give a coach a couple of gray hairs. Trying to go for it on third and a long yard that deep in your own end this early in the ball game. And I know, hey, listen, they got maybe the best short yardage quarterback in the league in Tommy Stevens. He's a big boy, and he can push the line of scrimmage at 260 pounds.
6'5".
Come on.
It's like handing it off to a slimmer offensive lineman, basically. First and 10 now. Mayer fakes the handoff. Lobs one out. Going up and getting it and hauling it in. First catch of the season for Marco Michel.
A little bit of that athleticism that Jake Mayer worked on in the offseason. Get out there, throw on the run, kind of as he's fading away from it as well, but he puts it right on Marco Michel.
Michel rejoining the team last season, just prior to week five, I believe, ended up with over 700 yards, 3 touchdowns. Was targeted almost 90 times by Jake Mayer last season. Mayer now out into the flat. Quickly has a completion there to Reggie Bagleton. And the Ticats are all over that. Nowhere to go for Reggie.
A Well, both these teams have that feature guy. I mean, Bagleton won for Calgary and Tim White for Hamilton. So when Bagleton lines up way out there behind the other receivers, it's that cue. That's the read for the defense to go, hey, if they're putting 84 out there, they're doing it for a reason. I'm going to get them the rock.
Dexter Lawson Jr. with the tackle sets up a second and 12 from the Calgary 43. Three options wide right for Mayer. Stays in the pocket down the field. Midfield is where they go. And he finds Jalen Philpott, who missed all of last season with a hamstring injury, back out there and could be a big weapon for Jake Mayer this year.
Well, yeah, it's just the only question with Jalen, we saw a great game in game one of the season, his brother Tyson, but Jalen came off after that catch and it looked like, I'm not sure if he had a little bit of a limp or what it was. It may have been his back of his head getting the shot. So yeah, he's just getting evaluated down there on the sideline. Just want to keep him healthy.
No doubt, especially with Henry already being lost to injury again this season for the Stampeders. They're going to need some guys to step up. That was tough news for them in the preseason to lose Malik Henry again.
Yeah, but it's a good group. I mean, if Jalen Philpott takes that step that I think everybody's expecting to see, I mean, there was 140 yards for Tyson last night.
Yeah.
In that bomber game, Montreal Alouettes. So he's got Bagleton to help him along the way, and expecting big things out of Jalen Philpott for sure.
3 yards on that first down pickup. Hamilton 48 is where they'll work. Second and 7. Mayer takes it cleanly, looks to his left, throws to his left. But nowhere to go. Dexter Lawson Jr. wrapped up Clark Barnes immediately, and that'll bring up third down.
It is a big hit, and it's a good hit. But here's the thing about it. You see, this is a rookie corner in Dexter Lawson. Well, he's in his second year, but he's very, very little experience. Now, he plays off this and comes up hard to make the hit. So the next progression now for Jake Mayer coming out a series later, or maybe a couple of series down the road, is to double move him out there, have him come up, get running downhill forward, and then double move him, try and get in behind him.
Paredes, a 52-yard attempt, hit from 53 last year. This one is up. Does he have enough? Yes.
Wow.
Paredes,
nice.
2-4-2 to start the season. His career high is 53. This one from 52. Really, no doubt, his coach loves it. Well, it's time to set the tone and give them the lumber. Don't miss all new episodes of the hilarious and hard-hitting comedy sensation, Shorzy. Streaming now, only on Crave. Oh my goodness. Look at this guy. He's a firefighter, right? He's got to be a firefighter. First and 10 from the Hamilton 40. Bo barking out some last minute instructions into the flat, held on to, but not much of a pickup on the play. Let's take a look at the Stampeders defense.
Yeah, this could be a real good D for Calgary this year. You take a look at their veterans up front, Mike Rose, who led the team in quarterback sacks with 11 last year. But James Vodder is an interesting one. He only played 6 games, had 5 sacks in those games. Micah Always set a Calgary Stampeder record in tackles, and they pick up veteran Demario Houston, who led the league in interceptions last year, to play in the corner. This has potential to be a real good group.
7 interceptions for Houston with Winnipeg last year. One of them went for a touchdown. Mitchell dancing around the pocket. Guns one on the far side. Working against Houston there was Shamar Bridges. And he hauls one in. Third completion of the day for Bo.
Talking to Bo, they're going to go hurry up here. So we're going to get quick substitutions. But talking to Bo, leading into this game, about what he worked on in the offseason, said he worked on his feet. Said the one thing that he noticed when sitting with Scott Milanovic is that they went play to play, good ones. This coach didn't really say anything. He said, we're going to good plays, and then I saw a handful of the bad ones, and he didn't say anything. And then we saw some good ones and then some more bad ones. And then after all the bad ones, he goes, are you noticing a trend? And Bo said, yeah, my feet aren't right. And then they went back to the drawing board and got into it.
Yeah, a little back of a quarterback whisper.
Yeah, good. Well, really, really good example of that on that last play.
Respot the ball in the 51, first and 10. Near side to Dunbar. Dunbar taken down at midfield.
And it matters on even a quick throw like that, too, because if your feet are off, that may look like a real easy throw to make. We'll see what this flag is. But if your feet aren't right, and quarterbacks will tell you this, if your feet aren't right, look at Bo's feet. Steps out there, couple steps backwards, points that off foot, even with the guy in his face. Real accurate on the throw, giving his receiver a chance to do something with the ball after the catch.
After the play, 15-yard misconduct foul, Hamilton number 57. We'll go back 15 yards, it's second down.
That's Revenberg, the left guard, after the pickup by Dunbar and tackle by Rodney Randall. And that backs them up big time. Revenberg, an eight-year man with Hamilton. Second and 20. Mitchell over the middle, and he's got a first down. Went deep right over the top, and he's got Brandon O'Leary Orange pick up in the offseason from the Bombers.
Yeah, when you look at the depth chart and you look at the receiving core for Bo Levi Mitchell with this Hamilton Tiger Cat group, he's got some big targets. 6'4" and O'Leary Orange, Dunbar 6'3", Shamar Bridges 6'4". I mean, their best guy isn't 6'4" in Tim White, but I'll tell you what, they've got some big targets out there.
Takes them down to the Calgary 45. Now the handoff right up the middle. Butler, he's got a first down. Best run of this young season for James Butler.
Well, that's a big conversion on second and a ton there after the penalty. Nice throw over the middle to O'Leary Orange, and then that just gives your offensive line and your whole group a lot of confidence in a nice run to back up that big throw over the middle for Butler.
Setting up the final play of the first quarter of Friday Night Football. Calgary with a 6-0 lead. Bo Levi Mitchell in his return to McMahon, trying to change it. He'll hand it off to Butler. Butler finds another hole, and he's got another first down. Back-to-back first down carries from Butler, who's gone back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons. Great addition for the Hamilton Tiger Cats when they picked him up beginning of last season. Tiger Cats are marching. They trail, though, 6-0 after the opening quarter of Friday Night Football. Welcome back to McMahon. Calgary leading 6-0 after the opening quarter. The big story, obviously, coming into the game. Bo Levi Mitchell back here with the Ticats. What did you think of his first quarter?
Well, overall stats pretty close, but yeah, Bo Levi Mitchell, I think that throw to O'Leary Orange that we just saw late in that first quarter was an indication of a Bo throw. That was a Bo throw. Now, they got the run game going, too, in this drive, so it's going to help get a little balance in the offense, but he looks pretty good.
Welcome back to their house, Mr. Mitchell. Completed 4 in a row. Seventh play of this drive. Last couple big runs from Butler. Butler now 24 yards on 3 carries. Calgary, I mean, depending on how this drive goes, but Calgary's got to be okay with their start. They're leading 6-0 after 15 minutes. Jake Mayer's 5 of 7 for 68 yards on the other side of the ball. Bo spread it around. Dunbar's got a couple of catches. O'Leary Orange has one. Bridges with one. And Tim White with one. Getting everybody involved early. Will they just continue to feed Butler on this drive?
Second quarter underway. Back to Butler again. Found a little bit of space. Broke a tackle and takes it down inside the 10. If he's going to continue to run it like that, you'd be crazy to not give it to him.
Yeah, especially on first down. I mean, you got to just keep. Don't try and fix it if it's not broken. And they're going right at the heart of the defense for the Calgary Stampeders. I mean, Micah Awe, I mentioned off the top, led the team. He's got a team record now with 134 defensive tackles. Another big year from Cameron Judge, but run game going right now for Hamilton.
First and goal from the Calgary 9. Three options out to the left for Mitchell. Back to Butler. Butler pushing ahead. This time he stopped just inside the 5 and eventually taken down. Awe, among others, in on the tackle.
I really think Scott Milenovich is that kind of guy, too. He's just, if a play's working, I mean, it almost looks like it's, there's probably variations. You're not going to go through all the blocking schemes on each one of these runs on this drive for Butler, but they look like the exact same play he's run 4 times in a row.
Second and goal from the Stampeder 3. Crowd trying to get behind this Calgary defense. Butler moves to the left of Mitchell. Ball looking to throw to the end zone. Back of it. Can't haul it in. Would have been spectacular. But Tim White unable to get a grasp of it.
Boy, just the flick of the wrist. That's what I remember when Bo Levi Mitchell was wearing a Calgary jersey and winning Grey Cups, was that quick release and the flip of the wrist. It's a little high, and that's why Tim White has to try to make an acrobatic catch. The family's going, we got a touch. Oh, no, no.
His wife, Madison, she wanted it, didn't she? You know, any of those other 6'4 receivers we were talking about might have hauled that one in.
Exactly.
Tim White, 5'10. This will bring Leggio into work. Chip shot right down the middle. And Hamilton is on the board. Bo Levi Mitchell that close to finding Tim White for the touchdown. Tough one. Well, a playoff appearance last year for Dave Dickinson as Calgary Stampeders, but still a busy offseason as they move on. Kadeem Carey ends up on the out list as we take a look at the offseason changes here for the Stampeders. What jumps out for you?
Well, there's a couple. I mean, DeMario Houston for sure. A couple Canadian linebackers there. I thought it was interesting. Matthew Schultz, who will back up Jake Mayer this year. His last start for Hamilton was against Calgary. And he played well, 225, 2 touchdowns, and beat the Stampeders as the starter that day for the Hamilton Tiger Cats. So we talked about this in the preseason. Often a free agent signing in the offseason is a player that played well against your team.
Yeah, we did talk about that.
Yeah, right. I would say Dave Dickinson was probably looking at Matthew Schultz in that one going, he's pretty good. If he becomes a free agent, I might go after him.
Be your backup, mix him in a little bit here and there. Back on the ground.
Now, having said that, I mean, there he is helping out. Whether it's a dummy call or making some of the communication with Jake Mayer. But, you know, having said that, Jake Mayer is the only quarterback in the league to play all 18 games.
Which is big, being available, right?
Yep. Knock on wood. I always knock on wood when I say that kind of stuff.
I think that desk is technically wood. You never know. Okay.
So you verified that I actually did.
I saw it confirmed. Schultz was at Montreal for 4 years and then the last couple years in Hamilton. Here's Mayer down to the 40. And he's got Reggie Bagleton. And Bagleton hauls it in, his second catch of the game.
Best throw of the game for Jake Mayer here. Again, little play action fake and slides into that throwing lane. Because he knows Bagleton is hauling that butt across the middle.
He was running fast, is what we're seeing. Mayer started the game 6 of 8 for 86 yards. They'll hand it off to Mills. Mills finds some room, breaks a tackle, and down to the 20 before they eventually wrap
him up. Leonard with a possible touchdown saver right there.
You know, I think that's why Dave Dickinson felt real comfortable with going with Dedrick Mills as his feature back. You know, I mean, anytime you see player movement in free agency, it's sort of both ways. One, the player might be looking for a bigger contract.
Mayer had a little bit of time. Now he's in trouble. And he gets taken down at the 25.
You know, one, the player may be looking for a little bit bigger contract, but the other, the team is looking at, well, okay, if we lose this guy, then what do we look like in the position? And I think that Stampeders, it's safe to say, were pretty comfortable with Dedrick Mills being their feature back, and they still have that scat guy and the speed guy in Peyton Logan. Not to say that Dedrick Mills doesn't have a lot of speed once he gets in the open field. We just saw an example of it.
The transition from Carey to Mills was not unlike Bo to Jake, really. Had them exactly. Both for a little bit. And eventually, Kadeem Carey signs out east. Mills gets the job here. Second and 16 for Mayer. Dumps it off at the 20. And that's B.J. Emmons into the game for the first time after that long run. Mills headed to the sideline for a quick breather. And they bring Emmons into the game. And unable to pick up the first down. It'll be third here. And Paredes likely called back into work again.
Well, if you're a Calgary fan, you want the good news or the bad news?
Give me the good news.
Okay, the good news is a drive into the red zone. They get a sack, so that's what stalls the drive. But the drive into the red zone, that's the good news. Good, positive drive for the offense. Bad news, they settle for three.
Paredes, he's already got a couple in the game. Give him three as Paredes busy here in the early part of Friday Night Football. Calgary Stampeders on top, 9-3 at home. It was an eventful offseason for both head coaches. For more on that, let's send it down to the new Coors Light Corral here, which is where Britt Dort is standing by.
Yeah, and I might never leave. We'll get to that right away. Let's talk about Scott Milanovich first, though, because it's not new to him to be a head coach, but he has a new style of coaching. He told me, I wanted these guys to bond on a different level. I had to adapt as a head coach, so I forced them to be vulnerable with one another. Tim White told me he's never had a coach do this, and he could already feel a bond amongst his teammates before the season started. Let's move over to Dave Dickinson. Exciting stuff, new stuff happening for him. He's a Canadian citizen. He told me, Britt, I should have done this a long time ago. It's been a long time coming since 1996. I've been in this country. He said, I always considered myself a dual citizen anyway because I'm a Montana guy. I'm close enough. Now, he did tell me, and you guys, we'll see if we agree on this. Technically now, he's the last Canadian head coach that's won a Grey Cup.
Oh, my goodness.
Are we giving it to him?
that's a loophole that shouldn't be discovered. I want to say congratulations, yeah. But I really want to say about time.
That's great. That's great to see. And it happens quite often. Players get a chance to play in the Canadian Football League, come up, fall in love with the game, fall in love with our country, and become Canadian citizens. Good for Coach Dickinson.
Mitchell drops it off to Dunbar right in front of him. Dunbar turns it ahead, takes it out past the 50 for a first down for the Hamilton Tiger Cats.
And Coach Dickinson, of course, in the offseason and sometimes during the season, will coach minor football. He'll go out in the community and do some work there, which is...
So he loves the game.
Yeah, absolutely, which some of the players do a ton of and don't get enough credit for. They really... Canadian Football League players are out there in the community all offseason and during the year, giving back and helping where they can.
Fresh set of downs. The Ticats, 53. Butler. A little bit of positive yardage there. Dozier and Awe both there to take him down in midfield.
Yeah, talk about how I like this defense. The Calgary Stampeders looks good. Now, they've got to shore up this run defense a little bit. Butler getting... But you take a look at their corners with Trey Roberson on one side and Demario Houston on the other. I mean, there's the guy who led the league last year in Houston. And Roberson, who has led the league, has been a CFL All-Star at that corner spot. Those two good ones on the edges.
He led the league with 7 interceptions as well back in 2000.
and 19, I believe.
Then you go to the linebacking core with Mike Awai, who we talked about. And how about Cameron Judge? I mean, Cameron Judge had a breakout season, and he's played very consistently all year. All through his career. So, you know, when you think about his big year with five interceptions. But they've got their hands full with Bo and James Butler right now.
James Butler, 46 yards on six carries. Good job on the ground so far. First and 10 here. Stampeder, 47. Mitchell looks to his right. Now he's going to throw way down the field. Oh, in the hands of the intended target. Tim White so steady most of the time. Can't haul that one in.
You know, when I look at the flags on the goalposts, it doesn't look like there's much wind, but there must be more, because it looked to me like Tim White was almost playing this like a center fielder, trying to play the wind and where it might end up, and maybe the wind pushed that a little bit. He was trying to track that down. The wind was moving that ball around through the air, and he just couldn't corral it.
Had the separation on Roberson for sure. Do it again. Second and 10. Everybody out to the right here for Mitchell. Looks to the left. Throws to the left. And that one over the head of the intended target. Not close to Shamar Bridges.
By the way, you mentioned that he got in behind Roberson. And you know what Roberson said when he got back to the huddle? That's just an incompletion. That's a long incompletion. That's all that is. That's what you say as a defensive back. You got beat, but they didn't complete the throw. So you come back saying, yeah, that's a defense. That's a win. That's
job's it. Done.
Job done.
Eric Brooks, one of the Stampeders back awaiting the kick. Nick Constantinou. Just drop one in here. That bounces at the eight. And we'll roll all the way into the end zone with about 5.5 minutes remaining in the ball game. Ticats have been close a couple of times. Tim White, feel like he's due. Fingertips, not enough. Milanovic around the organization last year, got a feel for it, takes over as head coach, and here's a look at some of the ins and outs for the Ticats in the offseason.
Yeah, I mentioned a couple of the D linemen that they've moved over. Luther Akunavanu was a former Calgary Stampeder, and this Hamilton defense looks different without Simone Lawrence in it. 742 defensive tackles, 35 quarterback sacks, 15 interceptions. And I would say a love-hate relationship with the Canadian Football League fans across the country. Some loved them, a lot loved them in Hamilton. Some love to hate them.
Mayer out of the pocket on the left to the right. And he's got a completion on the far side of the field to Clark Barnes.
Simone is still in the organization with the Hamilton Sports Group and is a community ambassador, so good luck to him and his new journey. And to Hamilton defense, we'll have to look to Kyle Wilson for that leadership in the linebacking core. He's playing in the middle. And of course, Katsitonis at safety can help out with some of the young guys too back there in the middle of the secondary.
Wilson played 10 games last year, 11 tackles, 4 special teams tackles. Now right up the middle once again. Dedrick Mills spins, stays on his feet, and another spin will get him down to the 35. Both running backs putting on a heck of a display here in the first half.
Yeah, we are seeing some nice run game. I mean, you know, there's a trend that we're watching over the last few years, teams going more and more to the run. Nice hole created up front. Kick out block. Like a pulling guard there, but Dedrick Mills hits it, and then it's a couple extra, about 6 extra yards with 2 spin moves.
Down to the Hamilton 35. Stampeders have had to settle for 3 field goals thus far. Bear this time near side, and another completion for another first down, and it's another catch from Barnes, team leading third of the game.
Again, a guy who went through some injuries last year in his rookie season, but did enough to be the nominee for outstanding rookie. So expecting big things in year two from Clark Barnes.
He thought it was a first down. I thought it was a first down. They mark it just short of a first down. So,
well, if they went for it on third and
now they're going for it here. And it's Tommy Stevens time, and he's got enough. Basically just needed the 25. They were almost there. First down Calgary, and this drive late in the second quarter continues for the Stamps.
Is there fantasy short yardage quarterbacks? Like, can you
touchdowns?
Oh, touchdowns.
Touchdowns are big.
Okay, because
I answered that quickly, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
I like fantasy sports. Okay.
Yes, you did. Because if there was a short yardage quarterback fantasy pick, Tommy Stevens is my guy.
Six touchdowns last season, nine touchdowns the year before. We called them vultures in fantasy. Oh. Touchdown vulture. Mayer takes the handoff. Now look at this. There's a ton of room. Something to work with here for Mills. Stays on his feet at the 10, taken down. Tripped up just shy of the 5.
Really nice play call here.
This is the 3-minute warning. Three-minute warning.
Big night for Dedrick Mills continues. He's over 75 yards in this game. Calgary with the lead, knocking on the door as well.
Played first half despite the fact we've had no touchdowns. The kickers are 4 for 4 on field goals. You know why?
What's going on
no
with
chips?
I don't want
we got them all.
Oh, no.
Those chips pretty are good. Really small.
Don't let Milk have any.
No, I don't want any chips.
Micro,
no chips.
Micro chips.
Dude, I've got
chips.
You like these?
Micro chips.
Halftime coming up. Calgary on top, looking to add to the lead that is currently 9-4. Second trip inside the red zone. First and goal from the Hamilton 7. Mayer drops one in.
Michael's going to want to put this football in the trophy case. There it is. Make sure you get that first one. Get it painted up, and he does it in style. Jake Mayer just puts some air on that one, gives him a chance to take a shot at it, uses that right hand only, and reels it in.
Hey, Jake.
Yes.
29-year-old Echols out of Western Kentucky. Spent the last couple of years in the USFL, but was actually on the Ticats practice roster for a couple of seasons. Now he's got a touchdown against a team that he couldn't crack.
Let's go, Larry. Let's go, man. Let's go.
Nothing fancy about the route. Just it's spectacular on the catch, but he just has to work his way through some of the secondary trying to disrupt him and jam him, and he just gets through there and then skies for the ball, brings it down with the one hand. His quarterback gave him a chance. He went and got it. Nice.
While chatting with his coach and his quarterback this week, and Reggie Bagleton, when we said, what about the receiver group this year? This was one of the guys he talked about. He said Cam Echols is going to be a big pickup for us. And he came through here early. Jake Mayer feeling pretty good about himself as well. And he should. Mayer's 11 of 13 for 141 yards and a touchdown.
Well, now a couple of trips too where he got the drives going. And Dedrick Mills getting involved with some big runs. Now he's got the Hamilton defense guessing a little bit.
They go to review. The 7-play, 70-yard drive that took just 3 minutes and 6 seconds.
Well, Dedrick Mills with almost 100 yards from scrimmage in the first half has got, that plants a seed in the mind of the linebackers, and now they've got their eyes on Mills. They can't get as deep. That leaves the secondary in the one-on-ones, and Echols goes up and gets it. I mean, he was triple, because there were three guys around.
Yeah.
And he went and got it.
Another weapon for Mayer in this Calgary offense as they kick it away with just over 2 minutes to play. And that's brought back up the far side of the field. Decent little return there from Lawrence Woods. And not bad field position for Bo Levi with still over 2 minutes to work with.
Hey, look at those numbers. Could be better for Bo Levi Mitchell if you missed a couple of throws down the end zone. That one to Tim White that just went off the fingertips, and on the other opposite side a couple of drives earlier down in the red zone and didn't finish.
That was Tim White as well. Yeah, to the end zone.
Yep.
A couple of Tim White catches away from a much different story here in the first half. Mitchell gets this one away. Takes it back inside the 35. What a swing late here in the first half.
Yeah, it is, because there's time here for Jake Mayer. I mean, this is the one where it's an open route, an open receiver, and Bo Levi Mitchell just sails the ball here. And they may have to go back and check the feed again. I mean, that curl route was there. It was the right place to throw the ball, just not the right placement. You overthrow one intermediate, and an intermediate route, you overthrow it and a DB is going to be there, especially that one.
He was looking for Shamar Bridges, the rookie out of Fort Valley State.
Hey, yo!
In Houston, much like
I know I keep trying.
In Winnipeg, lurking around right where he needed to be, and he puts his team in a great spot. Ball bubbled, but then picked up and taken ahead for positive yardage. That story could have ended differently.
Well, you know, the issues in the second quarter, remember that throw to O'Leary Orange when we had the break in the first quarter? I thought that's a Bo throw. That's back to the Bo days in Calgary. You see the little bit of a adventure there on that play for Calgary. But since then, in the second quarter, Bo Levi Mitchell is sailing the ball a little bit. He's overthrown his targets. Conversations I've had with Matt Dunnigan in the past, from a Hall of Fame quarterback, when you overthrow a target, you're often overstepping.
Something to watch for. As this one is handed off on second and six, they give it to Jalen Philpott, a guy that they can obviously move around the offense a little bit.
And the offense is staying out there. Occasionally, coaches will try and just draw the defense offside and get a freebie first down here.
Third and three.
Looks like that's exactly what they're going to do here. Try to draw in there with the quick count. And again.
One more crack at it. And they will instead let that clock run down.
Time count violation, Calgary number 12. It's a 10-yard penalty. We'll repeat third down.
Which now they put the field goal team out. So a plan to actually take that time count. Jake Mayer wondering if should have called the timeout or just take the penalty. Puts a little more pressure on Rene Paredes, but he has been perfect today.
This one will be from 43 yards. He's hit from 25, 42, and 52. This one will be into a slight breeze. See that flag flying bit towards the camera. Paredes puts this one up, and boy, he looks good. 4 for 4 to start the season.
From the north side of Yamnuska, big shout out to CFL Kickoff Weekend. Go Stamps!
Well, tonight we want to pay tribute to two longtime members of our CFL on TSN family. After over 40 years of working CFL games, graphics operator Randall Thomas is stepping away in favor of finally enjoying his summers off. And statistician David Moyer
who's been working on CFL broadcast since 1987 and has worked a record 35 Grey Cups, is courageously battling cancer. Moisty, we miss you, we love you, and the entire CFL and TSN family is pulling for you in this fight, buddy.
Absolutely. Get back here in a hurry, big boy. Especially coming into Calgary where Dave lives. And there's Randall. And, you know, Randall, who, congratulations. And a whole bunch of thank yous for just all the work that he's done with the CFL and having his summers off. You know, throughout the last few years, certainly he would walk to the truck from the hotel. Like, that's
what?
Have you ever, like,
no,
you...
I don't walk from the hotel to the car we have at the hotel. Wow. Bo takes a pop midfield. Wow. There.
Yeah.
And he's a little staggered getting up. Second time that he's taken off for a big gain tonight.
Yeah, and there are medical spotters that are going to be watching to see and may stop this.
It might have been Rose who got the most of them on the helmet. 30 seconds left to work. And they'll pick up the first down inside the 40. Let's take another look at this pop on Bo Levi.
Well, he looks like he's bounced back. I mean, there are medical personnel that are watching and can stop the game. I mean, they can communicate in real time to the on-field officials, and if they feel like there's a player in distress in any way, looks like he recovered, he got up, took care of this chin strap, and
well, and now we do have the stoppage. And they are going to take, I believe he's getting the news right now, that he's going to have to come out of the game, which he is not going to like, considering how much time is left here in the quarter, and they're on this drive right now. So Taylor Powell, a guy who Bo's a big fan of, will come into the game.
Well, you know, I brought it up because it looked like when he first got up, he was in a bit of distress. So, you know, you could see him kind of get up slowly. He reaches to the face mask. There are indicators for the medical staff to take a look at. And then he handed off on the next play. So I'm sure they were just making their assessment. Now he's got to sit out and be examined on the sideline, probably go into the tent. This is good. This is good for the game. And it's good for player safety and taking care of these guys. Because, yeah, they don't like it. They don't like coming out.
Taylor Powell comes in with the clock ticking down inside 20. Powell gets it away up to the 30. And a first down as he goes to Brandon O'Leary Orange with 12 seconds on the clock.
Well, it was a good throw without warming up for Taylor Powell, but he came into the game and he goes, okay, I'll just throw this, and then he gets hit. Accurate throw.
And Leggio brought out for the field goal attempts. Be a 31-yarder for the Ticats. Something maybe to build on at halftime.
Got too many men out there, I think.
Well, they sent a guy out late.
Yeah.
Too many players. Hamilton, 5-yard penalty, repeat the down.
A couple of those, I'm sure Scott Milenovic, you know, this is week one, but I'm sure Scott Milenovic will bring this up at halftime and say, hey, you got to know what teams you're on, what teams you're not on. And sometimes the injuries can mess it up. Not that the Bo Levi Mitchell decision had anything to do with field goal team.
Yeah. Backs him up. This will now be from basically 35 yards for Leggio. Already has one here tonight looking for another. And the kickers have been outstanding on Friday Night Football. Barlow getting into it with Alway. Barlow brought in this season. Grey Cup champion back in 2022. Can you build on points? Just the 3 points?
Something, yeah, no, right? Absolutely. You get, you know, it's a positive. It's the two or three plays here for the Hamilton offense that you can build off of more than anything. And then, you know, yeah, points. I mean, try to get it to a one possession game, and then we take it into the final 3 minutes, which is the best 3 minutes in all of sports. Canadian football final 3 minutes. 60% of the games were decided in that final 3 minutes last year.
Kind of exciting, isn't it? Ticats, they trail, but they had a couple of touchdowns on the fingertips of Tim White that he was not able to haul in. On the other side, Jake Mayer, 11 of 13, 141 yards, a touchdown, and a nice first half for Jake.
Yeah, after the first quarter, he was actually beating Bo Levi Mitchell in passing yards, but they hadn't really put together long drives. They did in the second quarter, and then through the touchdown strike as well. Got all his receivers going, and Cam Echols gets his first in the Canadian Football League late in the half.
Jake Mayers with Britt Dort.
All right, Jake, you talked about Echols being that piece in your receiver group that you needed to add some depth. How good did it feel to get the first touchdown of the year out of the way, but did you give it to that guy?
Yeah, he's competitive as hell. He works his ass off. He knows where he needs to be. You know, for being a rookie, he's learned everything at a really high clip. So, yeah, happy for him.
Speaking of being competitive, you've talked to me. Bo's talked to me about how you two are very competitive with one another. How did it feel to officially take to the field against him tonight?
It's fun. It's a joy for both of us, both of our families, to be able to have this game happen. We got another half to play.
All right, we'll have a good second half.
Thank you.
All right, we'll send it back over to Farhan in the panel.
Thank you very much, Britt, along with the panel, Milt, Davis, Enoch. And we're going to start with Lapo. So much talk about Bo Levi Mitchell heading into this game, but there's a guy on the other side. Britt just talked to him. He's pretty fired up too, and I think he's been pretty good so far, Lapo.
Yeah, I was very concerned with Jake Mayer to start the season. This is a big year for him. Last in the CFL last year in completion percentage. There's a lot of good things in his game to start today. He's got to be somebody that got to be the best player on the field. And sometimes people say, well, he's young, he's playing, he played all 18 games. He's got to be the best quarterback on the field. Here's some clips of him. First of all, he's done a great job of using his legs in this game. He sits here walking around. Last year, he was struggled mightily throwing the ball downfield. Great throw here to Cam Echols early on. I love this scheme right here. Watch what happens here. Two players together. It's man coverage. What you try to do, you force a switch and run away. What does that mean? One goes out. There's a player inside leverage on an outside.
I was going to ask about Dietrich Mills. He's a physical back. You've obviously had to tackle him. I didn't know he's a physical runner.
He's a physical back. Yeah. He's not little. He's right. Physical, and he can move. He's shifty. He's not the fastest guy out there, but he's got good enough speed that he can
hurt
you.
He
definitely did run me over.
You're wrong, number 10.
Milt, you're getting old. You're losing your eyesight.
Well, we're seeing some jitters from first game looks for Hamilton. They've had a couple of penalties and a couple of time count violations on special teams and offensively. They got to clean that one up if they want to get back into this game. Down 12 going into the half. Just one touchdown so far in the first half, but close to 400 yards of offense. There's been a lot to like. We'll have more to like when we come back with some straight fire.
Nice job, Lapo.
Balling like it's game time.
Hey, we're not done yet after this one. Two more games this weekend. We have got Saskatchewan in Edmonton. Note the early start there at 2 o'clock local time. We'll celebrate Edmonton's 75th year. So a lot going on there. Two teams with a lot at stake this season. And then after that on Sunday, we have got the Lions in Toronto to take on Cameron Dukes and the Argos. Milt's preseason Grey Cup pick, VA and the Lions. Going up.
We saw Hugh Campbell yesterday, too, and he was the architect a lot of that, and didn't get a chance to mention him. We saw him in the video, so I want to give some love to the architect, a lot of those teams.
There it is.
The great Hugh Campbell.
Absolutely. And again, his son, Rick, coaches, of course, with the BC Lions. But we want to get to a segment that was a lot of fun last year, Straight Fire. We invite everybody to send in their videos. Now, this is week one, so we're going to get most of this from preseason, but yep, still a lot to like, even though there wasn't a lot at stake as far as these games are concerned. How about this? We saw Tyson Philpott have a big game last night. This catch in traffic in the preseason, just fabulous. Straight fire right there.
Straight fire. Well, let's go to Ottawa and Devontae. Dead man walking. That's what happens when this man is returning punts. And he's not only quick or fast, he's also stout. So if you're going to try to tackle him with them arms, it's not going to happen. He gave him a couple of dead legs into the end zone.
What did he say to us on the sideline when you're there? Don't kick it to me.
Don't kick it to me. Look at that.
Don't do it.
Dead man walking with Devontae Deadman with the punt return for the touchdown. It was straight fire.
Deadman is deadly, but we got to look at my man. He's got the whole of Ontario on his back right now. Toronto, Cam Dukes. Uh-huh. He pulls the ball back. Oh, my goodness. Look at that. Oh, and he found his receiver. I don't even know how he saw his receiver, but ooh, got it. Be quiet. Look, that was impressive. Touchdown, Cam Dukes.
Straight fire.
That's a tough play. He's a tough guy. Don't call him Cam. Don't call him Daisy Dukes. Here we go. Cody Fajardo. No, it's not Cody Fajardo. God dang, that's Trevor Harris. This Keon Schaefer Baker. If you're able to put your body in this, contort it, stretch out and make a play, that's going to go a long way to beating your rivals, the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
Baker.
Straight fire.
Boy, I'm telling you, Milt used to make those catches basically on a Thursday. Daisy Dukes.
Leave it alone.
But again, look, I'd like you to send us your videos, any level, high school, youth football, college football, send it to us. Hashtag CFL Straight Fire. You can tag CFL on TSN, and we will make sure that your highlights get on this segment. When we return, it is the second half of play from McMahon. Plenty of first half highlights. Jake Mayer had a lot to like. The running backs had a lot to like. We'll see what we can come up with.
And don't send us any pictures of you and Daisy Dukes. We don't want them.
Leave it alone.
Depends who.
Let them live. Let them live.
Gets you fired up, doesn't it? Gets me fired up. Friday Night Football back for another season here in Calgary. Stampeders lead 19-7. Ticats 93 rushing yards in that first half, 63 of them from James Butler. He's with Art Brittor.
All right, well, you were a game time decision, but you wouldn't even know it based on that performance in the first half. How did it feel to step on the field and get some carries here in the 2024 season?
Feels good, you know. Obviously, it's my first action. Didn't get a chance to play in the preseason, so it's nice to be out there with the guys.
Well, I know that every game is a must win, but how motivated is this group to get the win here tonight for your quarterback?
Yeah, it's always about, you know, trying to start the season off 1-0, so that's the plan right here. We just got to go finish this half and finish this game.
All right, well, have a great second half.
Thank you.
Not easy to go back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons in this league with two different teams, but he's managed to do it. That's how good he is.
Well, I thought both running backs in the first half were excellent. Dedrick Mills for Calgary and James Butler.
Both guys, we mentioned 63 yards for Butler on just 7 carries. Mills at 71 on 9 carries, and we are underway here in the third quarter. That is taken just inside the 20 by Eric Brooks. Lunges ahead, takes it almost to the 35. Here's Dedrick Mills, who we were just talking about as well. Some hard yards there from Mills.
Yeah, and we talked about him platooning last year with Kadeem Carey, and you know, now it's his job this year in Calgary. Last year, though, even though he was playing sort of half the time, 3 weeks he led the league in rushing. So, you know, they knew what they had. They had a good first half.
Jake Mayer, 11 of 13, near side, wide open, has a completion as he goes to Clark Barnes. That's a team-leading fourth catch of the game for Clark Barnes, who had just 25 catches last year, missed some time due to injury.
Former third-round pick back in 21, 24th overall out of Guelph, and yeah, they're expecting big things out of him, too. Mentioned his injuries last year that kind of slowed him down, but
just 23 years old.
Yeah, oh yeah.
So lots of time, even after an injury-plagued season just a year ago. Second and four. And right up the middle, a first down for Calgary. Dedrick Mills again, and he is moving his way up. You know, like 100 yards is in the cards here for Mills.
Well, Dustin, you know that your running game is working, and I think both these teams here tonight can feel that way when you go in the Canadian Football League on second and four and you run the ball. I mean, not many coaches do that, but you know you have confidence in your game and it's going well. You're right back to Dedrick Mills.
He's averaging 7.7 yards per carry. Back on the ground again this time. It's Evans, and he is picked up and taken down by Kenneth George Jr.
Yeah, Kenneth George, he basically, there's Evans that's going to get the ball this time, but he was a tackler at that halfback spot. He came up and run support a bunch last year with almost 50 tackles from the secondary. That's a good form tackle. The open field.
Started 18 games last year. I believe they were at corner. Now they've moved him around. The defense a little bit. Mayer far side. Enough on that one. Right to midfield. Philpott had to kind of go down and get it. Didn't have enough time to make a move with the ball. And that will bring up third down.
Katsitonis, I believe, came on the blitz down at the bottom. There he is here, and this is something that the quarterback has to know. He has to know if he can block them all or is there a free one. Now, he thinks he might have the receiver down at the bottom to block that up. So Jake Mayer just gets lucky on the timing there. He thought he had that blocked up. Really didn't, because Mark and Michelle got there too late to make the block, but he threw it in time. That's how close it is sometimes, that split second between letting it go and hanging on, taking a sack.
Cody Grace, who did not attempt a punt in the first half, called into duty here. And he lets it fly from about the 45, hangs up there, good amount of time. Comes down, 47-yard kick, taken back for a return of about 12 yards. Bo Levi Mitchell, good to go after being taken out of the game late in the first half. He'll have the ball when we return.
Run up and down first half for Bo Levi Mitchell. Looked pretty good early on. A couple of really nice, accurate throws. One to O'Leary Orange over the middle, but then in the second quarter, missed a couple of open targets, including Tim White twice. That was the big hit he took. Now, after another play, he was taken off by the medical spotter and is back starting the second half. So they went through an assessment, made sure that he was good to go. 19 is back leading the Hamilton offense.
Well, look at his first half numbers. Mitchell with time this time. Out into the flats. Decent move from James Tuck. Tuck trying to push it ahead. He's gonna be stopped shy of the 30, but leaves them in a second and very manageable situation.
Put that big right foot in the ground. He just, watch him just stomp that foot, boom, and then back inside.
Tuck, fifth CFL team. Montreal, Toronto, Edmonton, Saskatchewan. Montreal twice, actually.
Always have to talk nicely about the fullbacks. Because the other guy you work with.
I was going to say, yeah. I don't need that heat. Second and three. He'll hand it off, trying to push ahead. Bringing a tackler with him is James Butler. And they're going to give him the first down.
Yeah, that is saying something. You know, I reminded James Butler when he was talking to Britt there at halftime. And saying that he didn't play in the preseason. So, you know, it is quite remarkable. Again, question mark coming in if he was going to play tonight. But to have the timing and put together that first half, it stands up.
Third tackle of the game for Alway. Back to Butler again, and he finds a hole. James Butler breaks a big one, takes it up to midfield, finally knocked down at the 50. Roberson was there to finish him off, but James Butler with the biggest play of the ball game on the ground. 30-yard scamper for Butler. Puts him at 96 on the game.
So here we go, fullback. I hope Dwayne Ford's watching this one, because it's going to be the key block from the fullback tuck that springs James Butler on that cutback lane. He had to take that outside player first. Nice block there, and big run from Butler.
The Calgary 49 back to Butler again, and how about this? Another first down, and that puts him over 100 yards here in the first two quarters and a little bit of the season.
Take a look at that back-to-back years you talked about in the first half. 210 carries with the BC Lions for over 1,000 yards, and that's what coaches love. Coaches love the word consistent. They love consistency. Well, they love excellence and consistency.
Especially
don't be consistent
players.
Don't be consistently bad. They don't love that.
Right back to him again. This time, though, wrapped up and taken down. He's also heavily involved, at least he was last year, in the passing game. He had 61 catches last season, targeted 78 times as the running back for this club. So no shortage of touches, and well on his way to another 1,000-yard season with 110 already banked here tonight. Lee Trail coming to the game, standing next to Bo Levi.
Blitz coming.
Second and 8. Calgary showing that pressure now. Flag.
Time count violation. Yeah. Hamilton number 19. It's a 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Yeah, a lot of movement at the line of scrimmage there, and the Calgary Stampeders are bringing some from the secondary. They were showing blitz. Not sure if they were going to send it or not, but they were trying to get Bo Levi Mitchell to audible out of the play he had called. And they're taking a time count violation, put him in second and long.
Backs him up to the Calgary 40. Mitchell out to his right, has a little bit of room, now throws down the field, going up to get it, no! Bobbled and not held onto. Shamar Bridges had a decent look at it, and that'll bring up third down.
Well, you heard our Hall of Fame receiver in the panel at halftime talk about your big-time receivers. Your receivers got to make plays for you down the field. Tim White had a chance at a touchdown throw. He was in behind coverage just off his fingertips, and that one should have been caught.
Bridges not happy with himself.
Yeah, he knows it. He knows it.
That's a big one. And now it sets up a 48-yarder. Some type of wind gusting around up there. This might be into it a little bit, depending on which way you're looking right now. Leggio pushes that one wide right, and it'll be brought back out by Eric Brooks. Brooks gets to the 20, now to the 30, stays on his feet. He's got something cooking here. He'll get to midfield, breaks another tackle. Can he get a block? Eventually, they force him out. What a return off the missed field goal from Eric Brooks. That was almost a house call. Needed one more to get it done. Home side with the momentum.
Well, in order to block on field goal teams, you've got to put some offensive linemen out there, and that means that if you miss the field goal, offensive linemen are trying to make the tackle. Woodmansey can't do it, but watch the move here in the open field. Nice cut inside and bounce it back to the sideline, and Eric Brooks, fresh out of college at Fresno State, big return.
Great field position for Mayer. Can't complete the pass to Michelle, and that'll bring up second and 10. Let's go back to the return one more time.
Just 5'7", 174. We've seen these little guys. There's a, if you're a football player that's undersized, We've got a place for you. You've got a home up here in Canada.
I laugh that you said that because as I was putting together the roster week one, you don't know a lot of these guys yet. I looked and I saw him listed as a receiver, 5'7", 174, and I just said, oh, he's the return?
Oh, yeah.
He's the return guy.
And did in college, too.
And they might, yeah, they might have a good one here. Second and 10 for Mayer. Jake in the pocket. Gets it out to Mills. Not happy with a little extracurricular there. And that'll bring up third down. And Paredes called upon again here.
A little trash talking there. Paredes got the win behind him. I think it's influencing both the passing game and the kicking game now down there more than it looks like from, or more than we can feel it up here.
Yeah, it's a pretty, and we can feel a little bit up here in the booth. We've had worse, but.
Kind of gusty, yeah.
On the screen, on the TV, the wind would be blowing pretty significantly from the left to the right.
See, it doesn't look
at
like.
At the back of Paredes right now.
See, it doesn't look like anything there when you saw that flag, but yeah.
He's 4 for 4. Looking to make it 5 for 5. And man, has he looked good tonight. If you've got Paredes in your fantasy lineup, you're loving it right now. He's 5 for 5. Stampeders on top, 22-7. The action from Paris, France continues on Saturday as the women's final pits the current dominant force in the tennis game. On the line there. Tune in at 9 a.m. Eastern, 6 a.m. Pacific on TSN.
There's no crying in football.
His team's winning. Doesn't even understand the score yet, does he? It's past his bedtime, let's be honest.
Yeah, that's it. Past mine, too.
Here's Mitchell. Woo! Gets it away. Just in the nick of time, and he goes right back to Shamar Bridges, who dropped that big last one, and he's able to haul this one in.
Yeah, by design. You know, that's it. That's exactly what he did, and he did it by design, because especially with a young receiver, you don't want to lose him. You're going to need him as the game goes on, so go right back to him, give him some confidence, a little hitch pass there. This high percentage throw, and get that last one out of his mind.
Mario Houston with the tackle. Second and 4 after the pickup of 6. Mitchell wanted to go deep. Now he's going to go right over the middle, and that one caught by O'Leary Orange. And down to the 50 for the first down. Looks like O'Leary Orange will have a bigger role here than he had in Winnipeg.
You get a nice throw and catch over the middle. I love how Mitchell looks off this throw, because O'Leary Orange did have a defender close to him, but watch how he gets up in the open field. Now he's looking it off to his left and then just comes right back to it over the middle.
Strong hands there from O'Leary Orange. Mitchell drops, looking for Keandre Smith. Thought about running before he had it locked in. Incomplete.
Kind of taking their turns, aren't they? Took a peek.
Bridges, Smith, Tim White. Tim White was targeted 5 times in the first half, only caught 1.
Unheard of.
Yeah, that's really rare for him.
That's very rare.
There he is. Got to try to get him going here. Second and 10 from the Calgary 50. 3 to the right for Mitchell, 2 to the left. Rolls to the right. Throws to the right, and he's got one. Just outside the 50 as he goes back to Keandre Smith. And he hauls it in.
That's a veteran quarterback. Now on this one, in this case, you know, it's part of the read for Bo Levi Mitchell. He's going to get him on the roll, and he sees Smith being that third layer right in between the short out and that deeper curl or corner route, and Smith comes up with it at the marker. But again, gives him confidence right back.
Move the chains up to the Calgary 38. Back to Butler. Flag as he busts through the second level. This is going to come back on a hold, I believe.
Well, Mike Rose was getting up off the ground, so it looked like he got tackled.
Holding. Hamilton number 53. It's a 10-yard penalty. Still first down.
Brendan Bordner. First-year man out of Florida Atlantic.
He knows it. Step inside and then the takedown.
Julian Hauser causing the issues for him. First and 20. It's the fifth penalty of the game for the Ticats. Backs him up to the Calgary 48. Four-man pressure. Mitchell escapes. Now he's going to take off again. Slides just inside the 40. Back to close, just shy of the original line of scrimmage.
Probably just outside of, I mean, gets him into a second and long, but not second in a bunch. Good decision not to force it. Had DeMario Houston out there too, hanging in the area where he wanted to throw it or was looking to anyway.
8 yards in that pickup for Bowe, second and 12. Three options to his left. That's where he's going to go. And the tackle made neatly there by Dozier and stops Smith short of the edge to try to find that first down.
There were times last year that Dave Dickinson told us that Brandon Dozier was his best player. I mean, you know, there was games where he was just all over the field and racking up the stats and asked to do a lot of different things. He'll blitz or drop into coverage, get to man-man situations like he just did on that last play.
Third and six would be about a 41, 42 yarder into that strong wind. Leggio missed that just moments ago, so the offense will stay on the field here. Critical play in this ball game. Mitchell out to his right, dumps it off to Butler. Butler turns it ahead. He's got a first down. And the Ticats offense stays on the field.
Great play by the veteran quarterback. I mean, he actually waved knowing he wasn't going to throw it down there, but just to distract any linebacker that might be trying to track down James Butler. He was going to give it to Butler the whole way, but he just kind of points down there to try to hold off Cam Judge, like, don't come after Butler, and then just gives it to him.
You see Roberson turn?
Yeah.
That last shot
exactly.
Just enough.
Just a subtle little wave there made a big difference.
First and 10, just outside the red zone. Mitchell quickly finds Dunbar, gets some blocks. Dunbar will take it down inside the 10 for another Hamilton first down. And they're creeping towards the end zone.
Been quiet so far, but Dunbar coming up with this one. You got basically quads to the field. That's four receivers out there to the field, and three of the four set up for the block. They put James Butler at the other side, so they could have kind of run the screen play either way, one to Butler going right or to Dunbar on the left side of the formation.
First to goal from the Calgary 9. Mitchell has completed six of his last seven. Throws it here, finds his fullback, trying to stay on his feet, take it down. Just inside the 5 is where they'll mark him down. He was looking for his first career touchdown, was Tuck.
Calgary defense kind of ran him out of bounds there, ran him out of room, which is saying something on a 65-yard wide field.
Kobe Williams in on the tackle there. Second and goal from the Calgary 4. Final play of the third quarter. Tuck set to lead the way for James Butler. Mitchell gives it to him. Butler hesitates, gets wrapped up, tries to back his way into the end zone, and he stopped at the 1.
Mitchell turned right to the sideline to Scott Milenovich and showed him how far away they are from the goal line because he wants to go.
Trailing 22-7, the ball is on the 1. I'm going to make a bold statement here and say we don't see a kick as we get set to kick off the fourth quarter. Calgary. Home opener, Friday Night Football, leading the Ticats 22-7. Great fourth quarter coming up here in Calgary. The Stampeders lead the Ticats 22-7. Hamilton trying to change that here right away, though.
I love that in week one of the season, you went way out on the ledge and said, with the Stamps up 22-7 and the Ticats on the 1 yard line, we're not going to see the field goal. Look,
I don't want to say, I'm not going to say I can predict the future, but I'm either learning the game or I'm really good at stating the obvious.
No, that's pretty much what happens here. You're bang on right. James Butler's got 100. Dedrick Mills is closing in on 100. And yeah, this score here and a major for the Ticats makes it interesting.
That is what they will look to do here. Trying to push it through. It's Litre and he gets there. How about that? Litre steps in, takes the snap, and pushes it home. We were wondering who's going to do short yardage for this team. And how about that? A 13-play, 70-yard drive finished off by Ante Litre.
Well, they bring in the backup quarterback in Taylor Powell, and then they move him out in the formation and leave Litre to get the direct snap. But I didn't see a signal from the official. They must have shown touchdown and then...
Yeah, very quickly.
Hamilton was celebrating immediately, and Litre, former Stampeder.
Well, what a moment for a guy who played here for a number of years, from 2017 to 2021. That's his seventh career touchdown. And a big one for the Ticats. They now trail by just 8.
Well, a huge drive, too, and the accurate throws from Bo Levi Mitchell. A little bit of James Butler, the drive. Went 6 minutes and 18 seconds. Bo gets on the run, and remember, throughout this drive and throughout this series, going back to the series before, he had a couple of receivers that were maybe facing self-doubt a little bit, a couple of drops. He went right back to him, got him back involved, gets Dunbar involved, who'd been quiet all evening, and he goes 7 for 8 on the drive, 13 plays, 70 yards, and this is how it ends. Touchdown. One possession game, just like that.
The Calgary Stampeders last year started 1-3. Then at one point they were 2-5. Then at one point they were 3-8, trying to get off to a better start this season, leading 22-14 at home. We'll see what they can do when they get this ball back. Brooks takes it at the 15. Back to the 30. All the way back to the 50. Another excellent return from the first year player out of Fresno State.
Found another returner. Love it.
If you want to return kicks, this is the league to be in, undoubtedly.
Well, pretty much every team has one, and you just never know. I mean, they can break it at any time. There's so much room out there. Remember, 20-yard end zone, so missed field goals, tons of chances to take them back.
Mayer finds Echols. Echols makes one man miss and wisely steps out of bounds. That ball now onto the Ticats' side of the field.
Just such a lift when you get that return almost to midfield for the offense coming out. They just feel that much more comfortable than starting from deep in their own end and seeing... And 75 yards of real estate ahead of it.
Echols now with 3 catches for 34 yards and a touchdown in his first game in the Canadian Football League. Snap a little bit to the right. Mayer goes and gets it. Hands it off to Evans. And B.J. Evans takes it wide, far side of the field for a Calgary first down.
Rotation guy out of Fort Atlantic, and we've seen a few runs from him in the second half. Get Brett to check in on Dedrick Mills just to see if he's okay.
He's standing down. I took a peek as soon as you mentioned that. He's standing ready at the 50. Looks like he'd be ready to go. A little bit of run here to B.J. Evans.
The 46, Mayer with a little bit of pressure, gets it away. Bengleton, his best catch of the game as he goes up and gets it. First down, Calgary.
Safety low. Bagel knows it, goes right to the middle. Did a few of those last year.
Yeah, just a few, hey?
Yeah, just a few.
86 catches on 122 targets, over 1,100 yards, and 5 touchdowns for Bengleton. One of the best in the league.
He can reel him in.
Ah, fishing joke. He's a fisherman. More on that if we can get to it. Bear near side. Michelle has it. Nice move. Takes it down inside the 15. Ball pops out. And now a discussion on the near sideline. And Michelle is down. He took a pretty good headshot as that ball popped out at the end. I think he was already down anyway, but let's break this down here.
Yeah, okay, take a look on the outside. And okay, so Michelle has it here, inside move. Ball comes out, it was... I think the tackler coming over the top missed him. This will be a better angle to see.
So it kind of bobbles it there.
It's Katsotonis. Oh, he just gets the forearm and elbow into the head. And then for Mark and Michelle, that helmet hits the ground. I'm not sure he lost control of the ball, though. Well, he does once he's down. Like, I mean...
Yeah, like after his head hits the ground, then the ball pops out. A little bit of a wobble on the way, but it looked like he re-secured it. Batted out by Barnes.
It's Calgary ball, looks like, either way. Thought Katsotonis missed him when he came over the top like that, but he did get him with the elbow.
Dickinson not happy on the sideline. His team, though, with the ball on the Hamilton 12, looking to extend the lead. First and 10 here for Jake Mayer. Three options out to his right. Looks over the middle. Now he'll look to the corner.
Sit back without anyone in his face and wait for Barnes to clear through the coverage and open up, and boy, is he open. I mean, we're talking wide open.
Let's go, man. Let's go, man.
Team leading fourth catch of the ball game. Paredes knocks it through, and what a response from the Calgary Stampeders. The Ticats look like they had some life. Calgary sucks it back out of them. Sixth play, 60-yard drive, second career touchdown for Clark Barnes.
It's been a quiet night for Jalen Philpott, but he'll be the decoy here. There's Barnes in the second arrow. Now watch Philpott draw the coverage. Kenneth George is going to be in the inside quarter here, and he gets pulled up. There's Philpott, and George is going to step up. Now he's got to be back here in the four deep zone. One, two, three, four. And that's exactly where Barnes goes. Now Barnes goes into that vacated zone and is wide open.
Second touchdown pass of the game for Jake Mayer, who's 18 to 21 for 209 yards and a couple of majors. Lawrence Wood just outside the 35 before he is stopped on the return. Mayer only had 15 passing yards in the third quarter, but put together 53 on that drive.
Yeah, but you know, when you look at Calgary last year, at, you know, winning six games, 6-12, made the playoffs as we talked about, but you know, obviously they want to prove on a six win season. That was missing. You know, the opposition would be in here. They'd score major. It looked like momentum was shifting, and the Calgary Stampeders just couldn't find a way to come back and answer. They answered tonight so far.
Well, Levi Mitchell gets the ball back. Immediately throws a strike to Dunbar up to midfield. And now it's Hamilton's turn to march back down and find an answer.
Well, start with a real accurate deep out throw.
Dunbar returning to Hamilton after spending last season in Edmonton, dealt with some injuries. Mitchell over the middle again, all the way down to the 40, and that's Tim White. Just his third catch of the ball game. Only has 7 yards up until that one.
In that slot back position, right on the hash mark, trying to make it look like he's going to go deep down that seam and then curl up in front of the safety Bentley Sanders. And Cam Judge trying to get there from the linebacking corps.
Bentley Sanders, a rookie out of the University of Nevada. And his first career start at safety here for Calgary. Back to Butler on the ground. Butler, good blocking, takes it down inside the 35 for a big chunk on first down.
Yeah, they really, you're right when you mentioned that they got to get Tim White going. That catch maybe will be the answer to getting that and making that happen, because we talked about James Butler and his consistency, one in BC, one in Hamilton, rushing the ball. Same thing for Tim White, and that 1269 is in red because led all Canadian receivers.
On 19 fewer catches than the year before. Mitchell had to step up in the pocket, now out to his right. Looking for White. It got kind of turned around on the near sideline. Falls incomplete. And that'll bring up third down.
When I say Canadian receivers, I mean Canadian Football League receivers. But, you know, Tim White on that last one, he thought, I think Bo Levi Mitchell thought he was going to turn up. Like, he ran the out. He thought he was going to turn up, and then he put the brakes on. He threw it to the up turn. He's been targeted 8 times in just a couple of catches. But they'll get that connection going. Don't, you know, that's... Hamilton fans don't have to worry about that. That's going to happen.
Legio, 2 of 3, made from 41 and 10. This one from 42 with over 9 minutes to play here in the fourth quarter. Ticats looking for some points, and they got them. We've got a 12-point game here in Calgary. Reggie Bagleton, one of the best in the business. More on 84 when we return. Reggie Bagleton, a 2-time All-Stars, caught a pass in 53 straight games, training in the offseason, but that's not all he did. Let's send it down to Britt Dort for more.
Yeah, one of the busiest guys in the offseason, and that included actually a trip with World Vision and some guys from across the league, including Tim White, who's on the field as well tonight on the other side of the ball. They went down to the Philippines, and they got immersed in the culture there. Said it was an unreal experience. He told me, Britt, I came back a completely changed person, life-altering. They did a little bit of fishing. They did a little bit of broom making. Played some games with the kids who taught them some of the native Filipino games. I'm sure they taught them the ropes of the CFL as well, but he did say, I recommend to anybody, if you can have the opportunity to go do this, especially if you're in your early 20s, go down. It's life-altering, and you will come back a different person.
Now, it wasn't all he did, too, which is a cool trip and way to go. Again, guys giving back, but we found out that Bagleton loves fishing. Now, I think he's got some walleye. Whoa, nice. He set that hook on that one. I'm not sure if that's a walleye or is that a pickerel or whatever that is, but how about that?
Reeling them in.
Reeling them in, baby.
You're going to hate me for this, but I've never caught a fish.
Oh, well, come on.
My
entire life. I'll take you out on team time.
They look slimy to me. Here's Mayer out to his right. And that one thrown away on the far side of the field.
Yeah, I'll have to take you out on the team time vessel.
Use a rod, or do I try to catch one with my hands? How does that?
No, we're not going to. You're not catching one with your hands. Be salmon fishing in Vancouver.
A little bit different than I guess.
Downriggers. Yeah, drop it down and 60, 80 feet.
Ticats are going to get the ball back here. That's what they needed. Quickly get it back. Ooh, just getting it away is Grace. Good kick, though. Bounces all the way down. Backs Wood up. He's popped after a 52-yard kick from Cody Grace. Calgary Stampeders up 29-17 as Reggie Bagleton looks to reel in the first win of the season for Calgary.
Set that hook.
Big time football back on TSN. Week one continues tomorrow. The Rough Riders face off against the Elks. Tune in at 4 Eastern, 1 Pacific, only on TSN. Making the trip up there to do that one.
There are some flat out legends going to be in the house.
Big time alumni celebration in Edmonton for the last couple of days. And of course, tomorrow, Riders in the house of Commonwealth. Should be a good one. Ticats still got something to say about this one. Mitchell gets it away near side, reaching up. There we go. Nice catch by Shamar Bridges.
Yeah, looking forward to driving up the highway and heading to Edmonton for their home opener, 75th season. Talk about legends. Look at the quarterback room right there. Michael Riley, Warren Moon, Ricky Ray, our guy Matty Dunnigan, Tracy Hamm behind, and Damon Allen. Combined, that group has thrown in the CFL for 273,541 yards.
Yeah, how many miles?
That is 155 miles, almost from here to Edmonton. It's about that, from here to Edmonton.
Yeah, that's a lot of throws. How happy did Matty look, eh? That, yeah, that picture, that was great.
Yeah, that's cool. It's cool. Saskatchewan, Corey Mace, first game on the sideline, first real game on the sideline as the head coach. Saskatchewan Rough Riders, Trevor Harris leading that group, and looking for a big one tomorrow night.
Ticats can't do anything with this possession. Third and five, they'll have to kick it away from just inside the 24. And Stantanou knocks it down. A little bobble, but picked up and brought back outside the 35 to about the 37 after a 54-yard kick. And now some pushing and shoving and flag on the field. Few moments after the return, looked like things had already kind of been taken care of. Discussion here for the officials. Bailey Devine
after
Scott,
the play, 15-yard misconduct. Calgary number 21. 15-yard penalty. First down, Calgary.
Mark Killam, the special teams coordinator and assistant head coach, went over to chat with them. We'll see. A little late push there, and I'm not sure what Devine Scott said. He got pulled off the pile. He thought something was happening with one of his teammates down there. I think he went to support him. But not defending it either way. Can't do it after the whistle.
Backs him up. Calgary 23, Jake Mayer trying to seal this victory away. Mayer, another completion to Barnes. Barnes has a first down, tracked down and taken down by Mark Milton, but not after a big pickup. Team leading sixth catch of the game.
Yeah, I was going to say, this is a great start to the 24 campaign for Clark Barnes out of Guelph. Deep or shallow crossing route. Had to go all the way across the formation. It's tough to cover that when you're in man, and Wilson has to track him down from one side to the other. Ray Wilson playing that Sam linebacker spot, inside receiver in Clark Barnes. They get matched up, and that's tough because you're in a trail position trying to catch up.
Last season, was 9 games played, 25 catches, 234 yards. Touchdown, handle some kick return duties for the team as well, so you know he's got that speed and that burst. Back to Mills on first down, short pickup here.
Hamilton defensively has kept Katsitonis right down at the line of scrimmage a ton and tried to roll back their halfbacks, either Kenneth George or Richard Leonard, back to the middle. He's lined up in the middle now, but it's one to look for, because if they take 30,
out of the middle and bring them down into the box, which they're doing right now. He's up here. That leaves the hole back here open.
Second and seven. Bear gets it away just in time. Near side, that's caught. Bendleton forced out of bounds, but not before he reels in another one and picks up the first down.
See, when Britt was making that hit, and she was talking about his off-season training, and you saw the bands that were wrapped around the waist of Bagleton, was he was trying to make those cuts and moves with resistance. And that's why you do that kind of training, because Bagleton comes out, he gets that push on the outside, and that resistance, he fights it off, spins out of it, picks up an extra 6 yards.
Calgary, last season, averaged just shy of 23 points per game, closing in on 30 here in the home opener. Mills trying to find some room. Sneaks through enough. Well, that's Emmons back in the game. They're working Emmons in quite a bit here in the second half.
Yeah, and actually playing both that time, because Dietrich Mills was out there as well, but he came out of the backfield and ended up lining up at the line of scrimmage almost like a receiver. And the reason that Calgary would do that is that if you take Mills out of there and a linebacker goes with him, you're in man-to-man. If you take Mills out of there and the linebacker stays, then it's a zone look. It gives Jake Mayer a pre-snap read.
Mills stands in next to Mayer here. Second and manageable for the Stampeders. They need five more. Just a three-man pressure. Mayer, far side. Good throw over there for Tucker. And he hauls it in for a fresh set of downs.
A little outside leverage for Cole Tucker. Well thrown football, tight spiral right to that sideline.
Eighth different player to catch a pass from Mayer tonight. Good early season chemistry for the Stampeders. Clock ticks down towards 3 minutes here at McMahon. Big hit. Nowhere to go for Mills. That time is Kyle Wilson, the middle linebacker, just sitting there waiting for him.
Well, I mentioned the final 3 minutes, so if you're a Ticat fan, you want to hang in there, because this is the play. I mean, if your defense gets a stop here, this is into the wind. Rene Paredes has been excellent, but it's into the wind, and you can have two or three possessions inside of 3 minutes. McMahon is wondering why it wasn't
the three-minute warning, right?
Exactly. We might put some time back
on the clock. Calgary.
Well, Calgary forced to call the timeout there. We were kind of wondering the same thing, weren't we?
Okay, so they run the play.
This is the 3 minute warning.
All right, they have now called the 3 minute warning. Final moments from McMahon coming up Friday Night Football. Well, I know it would just be win number one on the season for the Calgary Stampeders, but some history possibly in the cards here tonight, as the Stampeders are close to becoming the first team in league history to win 700 games.
and of course, it's neck and neck with the...
What a race it's been.
with Edmonton, and one of the great rivalries in all of sport, Stamps versus Elks.
They put a few seconds back on the clock, resetting it to 2:42. Second and nine, Calgary from the Hamilton 36. They'll hand it off again. And Mills, with a good hard run, gets pulled forward, and it makes it a third down and about 1.5 yards.
Well, they'll bring Paredes out here, but that little time, I don't say it's a mistake, but it wasn't very smooth. the 3-minute warning and plays that hurts Hamilton Tiger Cats. They lost a few seconds there.
So we're gonna have
But Paredes has been money all night.
5 for 5, a long of 52. This one from 37. Give him 6.
Split it right down the middle.
Perfect night for Paredes. These were the numbers coming into the game tonight. Great battle among these legendary kickers. And he's gone 6 for 6 this evening.
Sean White still playing with the BC Lions. See him to wrap up week one in Toronto.
Well, the offense has moved the ball well from Calgary and they have to settle for a few field goals, but they got a couple touchdowns as well this evening, and really have to like the offensive output, I think, from Stampeders.
Well, you know, I think at times last year we saw that, but what we didn't see last year was, again, that response when the opponent did something well, or that they made a mistake. The response wasn't there. The next play, the next series, the next drive. When Bo Levi Mitchell went down the field and scored, Jake Mayer had an answer for it, came all the way back, had the major, and that pretty much was the difference here tonight. You know, that answer.
Return to McMahon for Bo Levi Mitchell. Not gone the way he would have liked. Rather be up 32-17 than down 32-17.
No, but I think health-wise, he's back. I see the zip on the ball. He's got that quick release. He's back. He missed a couple of throws. There's no question. He'd be the first to tell you that. But, thinking back to that game in Ottawa where he got hurt in the goal line, and it looked like he threw a couple picks in that game last year, but it looked like to me in that one he was getting back, and he had a few drops tonight. I mean, you know, there were times that he was on the money and it were, you know, relatively easy. That wasn't an easy catch, but relatively easy catches. I mean, Tim White makes this one. This is one where Milt Stegall said he's got to make that play down the field.
Far side. And that going up to get it is Shamar Bridges.
So that's the good news for Hamilton. I think Bo Levi Mitchell's health is there. You know, he's had a shoulder issue with his, you know, his throwing arm, and I think he's got that zip in the ball now back to where he had it before all those injury issues.
8-yard pickup for Bridges. He's been targeted 9 times at a team high. Now he'll get it to Tim White. Took a bop, but goes down just shy of midfield, and Hamilton's got a first down. The clock sitting at 1:54.
Yeah, and that combination is going to get on track. I mean, it started to as this fourth quarter has rolled on between he and Tim White. They missed early, but that'll get on track in a hurry.
He's looked for him. He also now has 9 targets in this game. Mitchell quickly underneath. Back to White again, and White picks his way ahead for a Hamilton first down, and they are marching. A quick score here, still some time on the clock.
Well, Calgary is playing off now. They don't want Bo Levi Mitchell to throw it in behind them, so they're gonna force him to throw underneath, rally to make the tackle, and watch the seconds on the clock run down.
They do. Dip underneath 90 seconds. Mitchell waits over the middle. Bridges goes up and gets it. Bounced away when he came down. And they'll mark it just inside the 20.
Well, he made the catch and went down. He, you know, the ground can't make you fumble, so I think they're ruling that he had possession and then was touched there down by contact, then the ball came up.
And now
I'm not sure about that, though. Well, you know what? I'm not sure they'll have evidence to overturn the ruling on the field.
We are in an official's timeout.
Coach Dickinson right down there to remind them that the inside of the 3 minutes,
the previous play is under review by the command center.
The command center takes control of the review process, so they'll take a look at that.
Let's take a look at what's happening inside the command center as they review this. Get multiple looks at it.
Mission control.
That's what it looks like. Well, here's one of the views that
so he has control, takes a couple of steps. Ball comes out on the ground as he's being touched. So they need conclusive evidence to overturn the ruling on the field, which is a catch.
Here's a look at it full speed. I think, like you said, could be a tough one to overturn in this spot, and it's a big one for the Ticats. Let's get the ruling.
After review by the command center, the ruling on the field stands. It's first down, Hamilton.
The crowd hates it. I think Dave might hate it even more.
He's asking if he could challenge as well.
First and 10 from the 19 for Hamilton. Knocking on the door here, trying to make a game out of it. Mitchell escapes the pocket. On the run, dumps it off down near the end zone. Lunging through, they got it. Touchdown, Hamilton. Keandre Smith gets it done. And the Ticats may not be done just yet.
Well, good movement and buying some time for Bo Levi Mitchell to get outside, and then, you know, risky throw to throw back against the grain, but he's done this a few times in his career. Again, athletically looking good, and the injuries behind him. Get the score. Go for one.
Leggio makes it an 8-point game with 1:11 remaining on the clock. A flag sits just outside the 25.
Five play drive, 72 yards, and 100. And a minute and 20
major
seconds
foul.
To
face mask, Calgary number 9.
Find the end zone. That was a controversial call. Dave Dickinson hates it, but it stood. I'm just not sure. Even if they ruled that incomplete or ruled it a fumble, that wouldn't have been overturned in that case either. So we'll just. But the reason that Dave Dickinson was so upset about it was because it makes it a one possession game. They score here.
1 minute and 11 seconds on the clock for the Ticats.
So this is the onside kick team, and Mark Killam is the onside kick return team. And he's telling the frontline guys to try and disrupt the cover team so they can't get a straight line to the ball.
A Hamilton recovery here would make things very interesting to kick off Friday Night Football here on TSN. Leggio sets the ball. Calgary with that hand seam on the far side of the field. Hamilton got to get it here. Ball bouncing. And who's on it? Tim White's in the mix. Calgary Stampeders look like they're at the bottom of the pile. Ball bounced about 7-8 yards out.
Yeah, I was going to say it's got to go 10.
Yeah.
It's got to go 10. It doesn't go 10. It's Calgary's ball.
Calgary Stampeders get the ball at midfield, we think. Yeah.
take another look at this.
Well, it's got to get to center field. The ball's got to go past that line, the C. And I'm not sure it does, because there's backspin. Now it kicks past the line there.
I think it hit a heel of one of the Tie Cats anyway. Right there, Catsitonis, watch his heel. Nope, the next guy right. Oh, it was a hand.
So he touched it before it went 10 yards.
Yeah, it hit Akuna Vanu before the 10. And Calgary will take over right in midfield. Leading by 8. They'll hand it off. Mills pushing it ahead. Look at that. Burst right up the middle.
That's when you need the power.
Yeah. Timeout. Hamilton, their final timeout of the game.
That's when you need the power, and Emmons showing that he has some power in his game as well. Getting that low pad level and driving for an extra 3 or 4 yards.
Same weight as Dedrick Mills. A couple inches taller is B.J. Emmons. Having a chance here to seal this away for his team, though.
Well, I'll be interested to see the injury report after this one. I'm not saying Dedrick Mills is hurt. I'm just saying they're...
I'm a little surprised he's not out there.
A lot of Emmons in this fourth quarter.
Some hard yards for Mills tonight. 87 yards on 13 carries. Second and 4 at the Hamilton 48. Multiple flags, almost every one that could have been thrown there.
Procedure, Calgary number 60.
That's a big one.
5-yard penalty, repeat the down.
Stops the clock as well. So penalty stops the clock, puts Jake Mayer in second and just inside of 10 yards, 2nd and 9.
Dante Demery, guilty party on that offensive line, left tackle for the Calgary Stampeders. 2nd and 9 for Jake Mayer from the Hamilton 53. 8-point lead. Handing it off again. Emmons breaks one tackle. Now another cuts it back in. Gets it down to the 50. And that is where he will be stopped. Heck of a run from B.J. Emmons.
Yeah, it was, because of not only getting, you know, 4 or 5 yards on the run when there was nothing. I mean, he was caught for a loss here. Right in the backfield, that would have been a 4, 5, 6 yard loss. Instead, he picks up 6, but he also ground down the clock by 10 seconds.
It was Casey Sales who he bounced off of. And now the clock will tick. Calgary will kick, and we'll see what plays out here at the end of this ball game. Waiting for it, Lawrence Woods. Cody Gray stands at his 45, gets it away just in the nick of time. Woods
can't give up the point.
Takes it, gotta get it out. He does, and if he stopped just shy of the 5 with 25 seconds left on the clock. Kellen Thomas down the field. Levi Mitchell, 21 game-winning drives in his career. Would this be something, though?
Well,
25 seconds, the entire field. Can somebody say Tim White deep shot?
Had him open in the first quarter and missed him.
Disruption on the field. We won't show it, but he's just in his underwear and he's got pretty good speed.
We won't show it, and you really don't want to see it. I'm looking away.
That's an upper body that looks like it hasn't seen the sun in 4 years. And he's taken down just inside the end zone. Job's done. Somebody had their moment, and they probably won't even remember it tomorrow morning.
Well, Levi gets a chance to now just work the clock here a little bit, but obviously he needs some mega real estate here. And you're talking about double throw, hook and ladder. Remember the old hook and ladder?
When was the last time we saw a good hook and ladder?
Yeah, it's an old...
Is that a fishing term?
That's a back in the day, no.
Back in the Bagleton, isn't the hook?
Well, the, I guess a hook.
No ladder, though. Yeah. They continue to get this taken care of. Good laugh from some of the players on the field.
Well, the secondary for the Stamps here are going to be way back. They're going to be off, but again, you're talking about veteran groups, especially on the outside. I mean,
so he looked for 20, 30 yards out of bounds.
Yeah, Roberson and Houston, two veterans inside with Randall and Williams. They're going to back off 15, 20 yards probably by the snap of the ball, be way back here and backpedaling. Well, you get time for maybe three or four plays.
Bo Levi's got 186 yards passing in the second half. Needs a good chunk here with the clock sitting at 25 seconds. Takes the snap in his own end zone. Calvin's going to bring some pressure. Goes underneath O'Leary. Orange hammered down at the 15 by Alway with 18 seconds on the clock.
Interesting call defensively because they did bring pressure and they brought it from the secondary. Kobe Williams goes on a halfback blitz that forced a quick throw and a tackle without going out of bounds. Aggressive play call.
Clock ticks inside 15. Final moments here at McMahon. Bo Levi needing a miracle in his return to Calgary. Goes over the middle and that is caught down just outside the 30. Clock sits at zero as he found Shamar Bridges down the field.
Well, they're just gonna check with the command center to check the clock to make sure to see if this game is over.
It could be.
That whistle blowed with a second to go. They're gonna put two more seconds on the clock, I believe. That gives Mitchell one more chance.
Timer, please reset the game clock to 2 seconds. 2 seconds.
Well, you know, it looked like Bridges went down and at about 2 seconds, but then he kind of got up again right here. But they're ruling that he was down first by contact with Dozier touching him.
From the Hamilton 36, Mitchell gets it to Tim Whites. Whites trying to stay on his feet, but he's taken down just outside the 50. And the Calgary Stampeders have their first win of the season, victorious in the home opener. 32-24, your final.
Wasn't the return to McMahon Stadium that Bo Levi Mitchell wanted, but it looks to me like certainly physically he's back. Some real good throws, some real good things from number 19. Not enough to get it done and get the win. And again, classy move with a real warm welcome by the Calgary Stampeder fans early in the game.
700th win in franchise history for the Calgary Stampeders, the first franchise in CFL history to reach that mark. Congratulations to them on win 700. Bo Levi Mitchell was the story coming into the game here on Friday Night Football. Jake Mayer ends up being the star, goes 21 of 26, 252 yards and 2 touchdowns. And the Calgary Stampeders, who started slow last season, off to a great start here at home with a 32-24 victory and win number 700. That's going to do it for us from McMahon. Send it off to SportsCenter with Mark Rowe and Nikki Reyes.